I gave people all the stuff they really needed. Social security checks, utility bills, TV guide.
I want a TV guidance counselor. TV guidance counselor. Staying up to watch all night, and everything's gonna be alright with my TV guidance counselor.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor, barreling our way into 2023. 2022 was progressively less worse than 2021, I guess we could say. So hopefully we'll keep that trend up with a progressively less worse 2023. I'm Ken Reed, as always, your TV Guidance Counselor. This is the show where each and every week I welcome interesting guests to discuss classic television, usually using back issues of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection as the gateway into our collective past. And this week is a very exciting episode for me, and I think will be a very exciting episode for you. This is someone I've wanted to have on the show for a really long time. This is writer, director, producer Rockne S. O'Bannon. If you've ever heard me discuss the new Twilight Zone from 85 and the episode Wordplay, which you probably heard me discuss a lot, he wrote that. It's actually the first produced thing he did. We talk about that here. But he also worked on Seaquest, he created Farscape, and currently he is working on my favorite current show, Evil, which if you're not watching, you need to watch. It's really, really great. And he could not be a better guy. Just, this was such a great, fascinating conversation, and is exactly the kind of conversation that makes me remember why I do the show, or this is really the reason why I do the show, is chats like this. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Rockne S. O'Bannon.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me.
Rockne S. O'Bannon, how are you, sir?
I'm very good, Ken. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm so excited to have you on the show. I think I told you this before, but your work comes up really often on the show.
I'm flattered.
In a good way.
I just assumed it. I didn't want any details. So
yeah.
I'll just say I'm flattered and leave it at that.
It's not just your name comes up and then we make vomiting noises for like a whole hour.
Exactly.
Yeah. Which would be great. But
who?
Yeah. But you know, you've been working in the business for so long and done so many cool things. So it's not a surprise that these things come up often. And as we go through this guide from 1967, I assume some of that stuff will come up as we kind of see some people maybe that you worked with or influences on things that you did later in your career. But this is one you picked from April 29th to May 7th, I think, 1967, or that I picked and gave you. I don't remember now. And we picked this one because when we talked, you were like mid to late 60s. That's when all the sci-fi was on TV. That was like the era.
Yeah, this was it's right in the sweet spot of kind of seminal television for me. I was in 1967, I was 12 years old. I don't know how I can now be 41 and be, you know,
well, there's wormholes.
12 years old, 1967. Somehow that's miraculously happened. And, but 12 years old and watching, you know, just, an absolute nut about television. And going through this issue, it's just amazing the number of shows that are incredibly just, you know, seminal influences on me. We'll obviously get into that as we go into that. Lots of genre shows. What's also interesting, and we'll probably talk about that as we go through also, but just how many of these shows have been the subject of feature film reboots.
Yeah. You know,
I mean, things because they are so kind of ingrained in the zeitgeist, or at least was for people probably to get into Gen Z, probably less so. But they just obviously were, ideas and premises, in fact. There were, you know, big ideas, big swing ideas and quite unusual. Yeah, I love being on your podcast. I'm usually on podcasts that deal with quantum entanglement, you know, so it's wonderful to be talking about this kind of interesting subject of television, which I, you know, have very little connection with. So we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, we'll have much less highbrow conversations than quantum entanglement. Did you grow up outside LA? You grew up in California, right?
I grew up in LA, and that's what's interesting too, is both my parents were in the industry. My mother was a dancer, a contract dancer at MGM during all the Busby Barkley days.
Oh, wow.
And she had stopped dancing professionally by the time my sisters and I came along. But that she was in the business. And then my father was a gaffer, a lighting director, lighting guy, who worked at Warner Brothers for 40 plus years. And so some of the shows that were airing this week, the TV guide that we chose, are shows my dad worked on.
That's amazing.
So quite amazing. And some of them sets that I visited because I would go with him every holiday, summer and spring break. And whenever I could, I'd go visit the sets with him. And so we'll talk about that a bit when we get into
it. Yeah, that was going to be my first question. So we'll see if we get into it. But both of those professions, the dancer and gaffer, are incredibly blue collar. Like, I think people who didn't grow up in LA, and which I didn't, I grew up in Boston, forget that like 95% of the jobs on these sets are like blue collar kind of physical work jobs. And it just so happens that that's the industry that they're all generated from. But there's very few people who are like the big stars and the Hollywood stuff people think of.
Yeah. And when I used to visit the studio with my dad, obviously we were on the sets, which is the most colorful and interesting place to be. But we would walk past from the parking lot to the stages, you know, past the buildings where the writers and producers were, and always intrigued me. Not a lot, but it did, you know, not as much as going to the set and with bright lights and all that. But it was still rather intriguing. And it was wonderful when I always had an interest in writing. And so literally I wrote my first pilot script at age 10. Which actually would have been around this era. There was a Man from U.N.C.L.E. Series that was on and at this time, and then also a Girl from U.N.C.L.E., the inappropriately titled Girl from U.N.C.L.E.
Yeah, but, she's not a woman.
Nevertheless, watched that. That was at the same time. So I thought, being 10 years old, I thought there really should be a Boy from U.N.C.L.E.
Yeah.
So I wrote a pilot for a Boy from U.N.C.L.E. about a kid who is a for what I remember why, but for some reason was was hired into the U.N.C.L.E. organization. Obviously a big fantasy fulfillment for me. I think you may note that there is no Boy from U.N.C.L.E. in this issue of TV Guide. So I didn't quite manage to sell it. No, it didn't quite go. But it was the very first thing that I wrote wasn't an episode of Man from U.N.C.L.E. I actually wrote a pilot script. So that was my thing at the time. But I was always very interested in writing and all that. So knowing that somewhere on the studio lot, there were writers and producers who were hard at work, always kind of intrigued me. And then years later, it was just terrific. I actually worked at Warner Brothers in the mailroom right out of high school. And then I got a job at Lorimar, a company that at the time was doing The Waltons. They had another show called Apple's Way, and they just were doing a bunch of pilots. Very, very, obviously very hot company, independent TV producer. So I got to work on the lot, which was great. And then personal best for me, there were a couple of them. One, I wrote and directed a film called Fear, my first feature film. And we got Henry Mancini to do the score, which is great—a suspense score, which he's actually terrific at. But Experiment in Terror and things like that. But he didn't do many of those, so it was wonderful to and Wait Until Dark, which happened to be a picture my dad
worked
on. I love
that movie. He worked on that
great
movie.
Yeah, I did. And yeah, and so it's great suspense scores that Mancini isn't especially known for. And we recorded that on the Warner's lot, on the recording studio there, musical recording studio. So to me, it was just wonderful to be back at the studio lot that I used to wander around with my dad, and now we're recording a score by Henry Mancini for a film I directed. And it was hard to kind of not feel that somehow I'd hit my head and I was dreaming all of this.
Right.
That was quite special for me.
So. It's so unusual too, as a kid that age, to know sort of how these things are made and still enjoy them. Like, the mystique hasn't been gone, you know, because so many people until they're like in their teens are like, this isn't just a documentary. There are people who write this, but still, you know, kind of being aware of the artifice, but still enjoying it and being able to get into the stories and that sort of thing is kind of unusual at that age.
No, you're right. And especially back in those days, I think we'd probably gotten a little bit past what people decades earlier had thought. I just thought the actors made it all up themselves. I think probably by the 60s, people were probably a little bit more aware that things were written. But very much unlike today, where essentially got everyone, including family members of mine, who are interested in screenwriting, and they should, because it's an awesome job, I must say. Back then, I literally can say I learned how to screenwrite from my father. Not because he was a writer, but because he would bring home armloads of scripts to me, because at I show, you know, because I was so interested in that. And I just read them and just everything. There were TV shows on the FBI, which is in something, you know, that's in this issue of TV Guide. Even those sorts of things, comedies, whatever he would bring me, I would learn from. Now, scripts are available, readily available online, certainly anything from the past. And even new movies, you know, people who post them are kind of champing at the bit to post them and, you know, to wait until at least the movie premieres.
Right.
But the day after they premiered, you can pretty much get the script of any movie that's coming out, and often pilots and TV series online, which is a great reference for me, too, because I still love to read scripts, you know, for shows and things that I really like.
That's crazy, because they were probably just throwing those things out, because my friend Dana always calls, like, the ephemera that I like to collect, and he collects it. He has one of the spaceships from Plan 9 or whatever, but he's like, oh, these are industrial waste in Los Angeles. Like, scripts are just like, toss them out. So your dad was aware enough to be like, oh, my kid would probably enjoy reading this, because it was just garbage, probably.
No, you're right. I've got the entire set. There was a Jim Gardner, before he did Rockford Files, he did a 1 year series called Nichols on NBC. And my dad brought home, said, here's a box of scripts. The series had been canceled. It's the entire series, season of Nichols, James Gardner's copies of the scripts.
with his notes.
And I've got them in storage. I've got them in storage right now, and I don't know what I'm ever going to do with them. That sort of thing is pretty remarkable.
I always had to rely on either mail ordering scripts, or I would get the novelizations, which were always weird because they would be from the shooting script, so they could come out at the same time as the movie, and often would have stuff like, that's where we used to get deleted scenes before Laserdiscs. novelizations, yeah. Which is always fun. So let's dive in here. This one is sure. Amazing, because on the cover we have Lawrence Welk looking absolutely manic.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, I wish people could see this picture of him, because it's kind of insane Lawrence Welk, right? no human being on earth has been this happy, you know, smiling this broadly. And I got to tell you, I mean, just the very fact that you've got a magazine that's got Lawrence Welk on the cover, you just got to imagine how it just had to move magazines that right. Way, you know, and it's just how many, yeah, it's like, so I'm suspect this is their Sports Illustrated, you know,
the swimsuit edition.
Yeah, of TV.
Some 6-year-old guy with an accordion.
With an accordion.
Yeah. The lady's like,
exactly.
Ooh.
So this is, they just were trying real hard. And he's also wearing like a blue t-shirt. It's just
turtleneck, you know, kind of thing. Like, yeah. It's like Star Trek-y almost.
Exactly. Like, but I'm glad Lawrence was happy when they took the picture. But pretty remarkable photo.
And then one of the reasons I sort of earmarked this one to share with you is because the cover story here is written by Isaac Asimov, one of the great legends of science fiction. And the story he's written, it says, now it can be told. It's sexy to be smart. And he's written a whole article in here about how Mr. Spock is dreamy.
Yes. And the operative word is long. Okay.
Yes.
These aren't little trifles. I mean, the subject matter may be trifle, but this is a long freaking article.
It's like 8 pages.
Yes, no, it totally is. And that's what's, you know, this is one of a couple of articles in there that are just, you know, super long. But you just figure Isaac Asimov, who is, you know, incredibly prolific anyway. But there are actually, when you read the article, you really do get a sense that it's stream of consciousness. Nobody that he knows that he goes to cocktail parties with is going to be picking up an issue of TV Guide. And it's probably a quick $600 or something. So
right.
Just super stream of consciousness. He came up with the idea that Spock is dreamy because his teen daughter, they're watching Star Trek, and she said, oh, he's so dreamy, which is a great 60s word anyway.
Of course.
Off he went on this tangent. As you say, the very fact that it's Isaac Asimov writing for TV Guide is just too kicky.
With this crazy commissioned art as well. Like, there's this cartoonish, very hippie-ish 60s art of Spock being covered in girls.
Yeah, it's very pop art, Crayola colored, bright colors, kind of an evil looking Mr. Spock, but totally surrounded by what must be 30 young women, all of them super young.
My favorite thing about Spock is he's from Boston. He grew up in a really rough part of Boston called Scully Square.
Now, you realize Spock is a fictional character, right?
Yes, yes. I know he is not Spock.
Yeah. Okay. Just want to make sure. You said Spock grew up in Boston. And yes. Okay. This is where my nerdness comes in. You're not
point of order.
Exactly. There is no Boston on Vulcan, my friend.
So, right. Anyway, that's how I'm we know it's a utopia. But Nimoy grew up there in this really rough area, and his dad was a barber and all this stuff. But he has sort of, despite his best efforts to like enunciate an elocution, still has like an old man Boston accent. So whenever I see Star Trek and people are playing Vulcans, because he sort of set the template, mm-hmm. they all vaguely have a slight Boston accent, which is always really funny to me. I'm like, all right.
Well, okay, maybe there is a Boston in Vulcan. You know,
there might
know.
Be.
Yeah, there might be. Prove us wrong.
Cold, emotionless people. I don't know. It doesn't track.
No, exactly.
Then there's a weird article in here that anytime I see anything like pre-millennium about training animals, I like instantly mm-hmm. cringe, because I'm like, what horrific Disney-esque abuse happened to these animals? But this one, the title is They Spare the Rod. So right away, I'm like, oh, good Lord. But it's actually a kind of a cute little article about like, these animal trainers are different. They don't beat the shit out of these animals to make them do stuff. They're nice to them.
They're the modern ones who use electronic devices. Yeah.
You know. Yes.
Yes. But, and then there's a series of photos of the animals doing things that are incredibly unnatural for them.
Yes.
So, you know, even if they may not have tortured them to get them to do it, they're still doing something that's kind of outside their, you know, there's a raccoon playing basketball. Maybe we'll leave it at that. But oh, yeah. there's a raven with a gun.
Yeah. With a gun, a parrot making a martini, a chicken playing the piano, and a cat presumably turning on a light, but it just looks like he's trying to commit suicide.
please be plugged in so I can just end this.
Oh God. Because cat doesn't have a bathtub. The cat bath is his tongue. So this is like the cat
like water.
Throwing the toaster in.
But I think pardon me a moment while I register the title Raven with a Gun. Okay.
Yes.
Because I think that's my next show.
I'd watch that every week. That sounds like an amazing like detective show. Yeah. And then before we get to the listings here, this really fascinated me. There's an article about television in Saudi Arabia mm-hmm. in 1967, which is a crazy sort of social, like weird anthropology article that was fascinating.
No, you're right. And that's what I think. The issue in general, obviously looking at this over the decades now, it's really quite the magazine. You know, I mean, it isn't just a listing guide and some puff pieces, you know, kind of provided by PR departments. There's some really, rich, kind of wide-reaching stories. And this is a good example of one. And yet again, not a short little article either. It's really, you know, kind of digs into it. Also looking at a couple before we get into the listings, a couple of things I thought were interesting. The there's a section that up front that they call As We See It.
Yes.
And it makes mention of the fact that now NBC is proposing an increase to increase the present 14 minutes of advertising in a 2-hour movie to 16 minutes. Okay, which I just think is like, you know, that's like, they're not making it like that's the new doom and gloom and it's the end of the world, but they're making the point that, oh, you know, other networks are bound to follow suit and regretfully. So they're really kind of troubled by the fact that they're, you know, they're 16 minutes of advertising in a 2-hour movie, you know, presently, you know, an hour of television, you know, I think, it's essentially around 40 minutes, 41 minutes of content.
So 20 minutes per hour. So yeah, it would be for a 2-hour movie, it'd be 40 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. So they should just put give an hour of ads and say, well, come watch your hour version of the movie, in an hour.
Given that, and you've worked in the format for so long that, you know, kind of when the ad breaks are and how many there are and when the ads increase, as they do over time slowly, it's probably a relatively easy adjustment. But like now you're working on Evil, which is streaming, and episodes mm-hmm. can kind of run however long they need to. Does it help or hurt when you're building a story structure because you don't have those ad breaks built into the structure of it?
No, that's a really good question. Because we're on Paramount Plus, they do have a pay tier. So there are actual act breaks in it. You obviously want to have a reasonable amount of content. It isn't as defined as it is on a network show. And most importantly is, as you say, it doesn't have to complete an hour. It doesn't have to be only an hour. So when you're editing for network, yeah, you've got to get it down to that exact, it's literally down to the second. It's pretty tough. When I work with writing staffs, I always tell them a great thing to do when you're writing, because so many times, especially young writers are like, how do I write a script? Are usually around 55 pages now. It's like, how do you write? And I can't get this. I can't get any more out of this. I got to turn in 61 pages. And I tell them, I said, and I always have my writers go into spend time in the editing room, because it's a great place to learn what's important and what isn't important. And so one of the lessons from the editing room that I try to impart to them is, if you're having to deliver your show, it has to be 41 minutes and 43 seconds or whatever it is. It can't be one way or the other. You know, maybe if you're Aaron Sorkin or something, they might like give you some leeway once, but they're not going to do that. So, you just have to cut stuff, even if you love it or whatever. So apply that when you're writing the script as well. And I think it puts them in good stead, and it's not a bad way to look at, to look at it in general.
So I remember a friend of mine directed a bunch of the Sci-Fi Channel, like plug and play monster movies that they started doing. And this I thought was apocryphal, but apparently it was true. They loved the movie Dog Soldiers. It did really well for Sci-Fi Channel. So they basically hired an intern to diagram the movie. So it went through and said, 10 minutes in, there's a death, or like, what, monster comes in at this scene or whatever. Mm-hmm. And he gave me the template that the Sci-Fi Channel would give to writers, where they were basically like, yep, so someone has to die like before this commercial at this minute, and this has to happen here and here. But within that, go nuts. Like, it was just to the second.
As long as you hit these marks. Yeah.
Yeah.
I did a lot of stuff for Sci-Fi. Maybe that explains a lot. That's why their notes were so, it's exactly the same note all the time. Yeah. Wow. Okay. Wow. I need to go back and reexamine that.
Yes.
Just going back a little bit, there was a thing about, as we see it, about the minutes of commercials. And then there's a thing called TV Teletype, which is always and there's another thing that we see later on in the back half of the magazine, were my favorite parts of TV Guide. Because they talked about just kind of behind the scenes and what's coming up and things that are going. So it's like, what's a pilot, like that. So this one is interesting because it'll talk about, for example, The Outsider, a 2-hour telefilm starring Darren McGavin, my camera and riverboat, will probably become a 1-hour replacement series for NBC next January. So things like that are just fascinating to me. But if you look at this one, and again, there's quite a few, it's a full page of this. One of the things they mentioned is Lee Marvin has purchased rights to some of Jack London's stories as possible TV series. Marvin's production company would film the show with other actors starring. I don't recall ever seeing this ever making it to air. But and then there's another one, Canadian actor Christopher Plummer, which I like.
Of course, yes.
Canadian actor. Is doing Oedipus Rex, which will be syndicated for American TV, as was his Hamlet. So again, how delightful of these folks to be doing, Oedipus Rex and trying to bring Jack London stories to TV,
right?
Just as they do today.
Yes, highbrow. So it's still news. And you get to see, and when we were first talking, you were like, oh, my sister always had the fall preview and kind of kept them. But, it applies here too. You see these roads not traveled. There's like alternate universes of television that you see in these things, like the Teletype, where you're like, oh, imagine if that did end up being a show. Like, what if Darren McGavin did that for 5 years and never did The Night Stalker? Or like, what if this went?
No, you're absolutely right.
And it's always weird.
If Lee Marvin's Jack London stories had been a hit,
yeah,
television today would be just populated with
bears,
action stories. And the other one that's really interesting, you tell me what you think. At the very bottom, it says NBC lets comedians Rowan and Martin run loose for an hour on September 9th. So I'm assuming that may be.
That was Laughing. That was the pilot for Laughing.
There's one. It's like, wow.
It's 67 too. So this, and when we're looking at the listings too, like that, aside from the very youth culture Spock hippie looking drawing, this, that really hasn't translated to television quite yet. it was really like almost, we're almost there, but it's like the season after where you start getting that, that sort of laughing, loving flower power stuff really starts to show up on TV, you know, a few years after it was already kind of in the youth culture, aside from
Blue Boy and
Dragnet.
Exactly. And no, you're right. And then also, you know, and Rowan and Laugh-In was, you know, was very much at the forefront of that. Smothers Brothers, which is actually on at this time, is it kind of led into that. I'm wondering if this probably, I don't know how long Smothers Brothers had been on at the time of this issue, but they started out as very kind of, you know, obviously straightforward, just kind of these kind of fun brother comedians.
Vaudeville.
Yeah, so I don't think that they probably made the turn into the far more interesting and far more volatile and doomed show that they became.
Maybe in summer of 68 or May 68, which is when they had Pete Seeger on doing the Big Muddy. And that's when the network was like, goodbye. And they replaced them with the Glenn Campbell Hour. So that was what replaced the Smothers Brothers like instantaneously with the same writing staff mostly.
Exactly. Which included who was on their writing staff?
Steve Martin, Carl Gottlieb, Bob Einstein. Mm-hmm. And I think that Albert Brooks wrote a bit as well later. With Bob Einstein, his brother.
Yeah.
Crazy writing staff on that show.
I know. It's remarkable. Yeah. And then they would show up in sketches too. So
let's dive in here. Saturday night, what jumped out at you?
Let me scrolling there quickly. Well, first thing that jumped out for me was just reminded me of Saturday morning cartoons.
Yes. Right?
Which was, you know, in my day was a big thing. A lot of choices and things you had to make decisions of. Obviously, being steadfast in not going outside to the sunshine on a Saturday morning, but sitting inside and watching TV.
California wasn't known for its weather.
Yeah, I know. Exactly. I have to believe you because I never saw it. Okay, so if you say so. Shades drawn against the sun so I could see my cartoons better.
Do you remember Space Angel?
No, I don't. I mean, there's Stingray, which I remember.
Stingray was great. Space Angel was done by the Clutch Cargo people, where it was not animated. It was like a cardboard cutout with a real human mouth. And it was like a space travel, like a pilot outer space, but that, like Clutch Cargo and space. And it's so
weird. No, as you describe it now, I do vaguely remember it because it was on TV. I would watch it. Clutch Cargo, obviously, I definitely remember. Terrifying idea, right?
Oh yeah, and horrifying and to this day.
As far from real as possible. You would have been better off just putting a still photo up there. And the other thing, just to speak to how the TV Guide was once a great publication, you look at like their descriptions of reruns. Right?
Yeah.
They will describe what's going on in that particular rerun of a Dick Van Dyke show or whatever it is. It isn't just, it's on, it's watch it.
Right.
It's like, they'll tell you which episode it is. And then I'm looking at Saturday afternoon and their description of sports. It's not just baseball, Tigers versus Orioles. It's as long, the Detroit Tigers meet the Orioles at Baltimore's Memorial Stadium. The Tigers have the pitching and power to challenge. It just goes on for the it's incredibly long.
Team leader, Al Kaline. Yeah, it's like a whole article.
Yeah, I know. It's like, wow, how thick is this thing? It's the phone book. But anyway, so, okay, now moving into prime time, even though I would not have left the TV all day, okay?
No, same. Especially if Frankenstein Jr. was on.
Yeah, no. Yeah, so moving into the evening, yet again, awesome that prime time was 7:30 to 11, especially ironic in the present day when it looks like all three networks are, pardon the expression, primed to give back the 10 o'clock hour to essentially following the Fox template and giving back the 10 o'clock hour to their local affiliates. And so, so that's an era gone. But this was pre-Family Hour, where they gave up 7:30 to local stations for family programming, which obviously did not happen.
No, it was just Jeopardy.
But anyway, so that was it. You sent me a Boston edition, so it's
yes.
You know, it covers like, I don't know, like five different markets or something.
Yeah, we got Rhode Island.
There's a million numbers on here, so I can't quite tell. I wrestle with what's, you know, original and what, you know, what's new and what's reruns, but just looking at the shows that are on here, Jackie Gleason, never watched it much. Flipper, obviously, we watched a lot. I remember we got our first color TV in 1964, And I remember we bought it and brought it home on a Sunday. And so I think Flipper was the very first show that we saw in color. And then I think Disney, Wonderful World of Color, was on after that. But I remember it literally, because I think we were the first ones on our block or in our cul-de-sac to have a color TV. Every kid in the neighborhood came over to watch Flipper in color. No, it was remarkable. So, and again, I'm stunning considering I'm only 41.
I know. As a two-year-old, you're in there with the color TV. It's crazy.
Exactly. I couldn't even reach the controller because,
right.
And you had to walk up to the TV to change it. I couldn't even, didn't even have a remote from my crib to change channels. But anyway, Flipper obviously would watch. And then Mission Impossible, looking at this, it includes the character of Briggs as played by Stephen Hill, which means that it was first season because that was the season that he was the leader of the MIF, Mission Impossible. Yeah, yes, MIF. Yeah. Right. So that's kind of awesome. And Get Smart is on at the same time. So if I had to pick like what I you pick like what I would have probably watched at the time, and then I look at what I would want to watch now, and then the other filter to tell you how much I got into this because I just love looking at this was what I would watch, not what I would watch now for nostalgic reasons, right? Because there's things I go, oh shit, I would love to see that show. I haven't seen that show in years or whatever. It's like, no, what would actually interest me to watch because it would be an interesting show to watch.
Right, like a curiosity of like, oh.
Yeah, no, exactly. So I would probably watch Mission Impossible. I would probably definitely watch. I'm sure it's probably available somewhere. Get Smart hasn't been. So I literally bought all 8 seasons or whatever a couple months ago just so I could watch it. And it literally, Get Smart is like literally, it's laugh out loud funny. There's things that I appreciated, comedies and things that I go, oh, that's funny. You know, one of those things where you say, that's funny. Get Smart is... maybe it's because I haven't seen it in so long, but I don't think that's it. It's just totally my sense of humor and loved it. So yeah, I would definitely be watching that.
Comedy doesn't age as well as other genres because comedy is so of its time that it's of all the genres you could watch later, comedies tend to hold up the least well. Like there's
the
really great ones, but it is kind of surprising when they do hold up.
No, you're absolutely right. And the ones that do hold up are the shows that, I don't know if they worked at it, but they didn't do things that were particularly culturally timely. You know what I mean?
Right.
So you think of the Andy Griffith Show as an example, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of the time, but it's not really because it's this kind of rarefied locale of Mayberry, which is kind of timeless. And it's even probably back in the 60s, right? It was kind of timeless for itself. The show that to me is the best example of this, which I could argue is the best TV comedy ever. There's a zillion other ones, and you know it's hard to say not MASH wasn't and things like that. But just for me, the Dick Van Dyke Show, the original Dick Van Dyke Show, which I just thought is just so incredibly smartly written. And much to their credit, it's relatively timeless because they didn't touch on topical humor per se. You know, they had an episode where they had their version of the Beatles come stay at the Petrie's house and that sort of thing.
Right.
But those are relatively rare. One other thing, just if I go off on Dick Van Dyke, just feel free to end the podcast.
Please do.
Yeah. Come back later.
Please do.
Come back. Go get yourself dinner and come back.
I'll be back later. But,
yeah, exactly. Yeah, really. But no, the thing I noticed about the Dick Van Dyke Show and the reason why they're so compelling, they're hilariously funny and they're impeccably cast, etc. They're mysteries. The episode, if you watch the episodes, they almost always, I would say 90% of the time, you want to know there's something going on that you don't know what it's about and what the answer is and why that can be, which is something that I don't know that other shows have done. And Carl Reiner himself, who obviously was doing it, I don't know if they realized they were doing that. I don't know if they did that by design or choice, but
I don't think so because he never really did it again.
That's my point, is that you watch the new Dick Van Dyke Show, you know, it's also called Reiner, it's also Dick Van Dyke, Hope Lang, very sweet, who played the wife in that. It's no Mary Tyler Moore, no, you know, in terms who of is. Comedy chops.
Yeah.
And it's not as, I mean, I've seen some of it recently, you know, where I found episodes on YouTube or whatever. Yeah, not good. Not as good. I mean, it just didn't catch the same lightning in a bottle. And again, if you look at it and try to distill down a factor, if not the factor, why it's just isn't as as doesn't grab you as much as the original show, is because the original one had these mysteries. And if for anybody inclined to go back and look at those, you'll see there each episode is like there's something that you kind of want to have answered.
There's that shortcut of farce that I think became sort of the model for sitcoms later, where the audience knows the answer to that mystery and we watch all the people have misunderstandings because they don't know, but we do, which is, I think, easier to do from a story perspective, but not as the mystery element of that show. I always call like a lean in. So you pay closer attention to everything that's going on and the characters can be sort of more subtle because you're more honed in on what's happening.
No, that's really smart. Yeah. It's really very, very true. So often sitcoms and things will go for the joke, even though, you know, it may be, you can probably justify it as being reasonable for the characters, but it just pushes right up against the validity of it, but they think a good joke is worth it. It's also just, there's a lack of wit. You know what right. I mean, I just miss that in a lot, so many comedies.
Keep talking about Dick Van Dyke myself as well. But that's why they could get away with an episode like the Walnuts episode, which is so surreal and bizarre and weird, but doesn't feel out of place on that show. And I don't think any other sitcom people would have been like, what the hell are you doing? But it just works and makes sense because it's in the structure and style of that show, weirdly.
Mm-hmm. No, you're absolutely right. And so, for example, it wouldn't particularly fit on Pistols and Petticoats, which right. is actually on, you know, yeah, which is on
later. I'd like
later,
to see him
later
try.
This, later this Saturday night, yeah.
Pat Buttram could it really.
It may have really helped the show if they'd done their version of the Walnut episode. But anyway, Pistols and Petticoats, not 9:30. I guess because it has petticoats, it's a little risque, so it was on a little bit later.
Yeah.
That certainly sounds junction. Like a, doesn't that, yeah, really, it sounds like a, you know, something that Pistols and Petticoats, as I vaguely remember the series.
It sounds like a weird store brand version of Dungeons and Dragons that your aunt bought you when you asked for Dungeons and Dragons. No, I didn't want Pistols and Petticoats. It's the same thing. Guy just said the same thing.
Yeah. Dear, yeah, doesn't this what I thought this was it? Well, try it. You might like it. Yeah. No, Pistols and Petticoats sounds like too much of a guy fantasy show. Yeah. I don't think that lasted lots of years. And then Gunsmoke at 10 o'clock with guest star Betty Davis.
Mm-hmm. And Bruce Dern
is also in it.
Yeah.
And then Julie Summers is in it and Tom Skerritt. And I swear Tom Skerritt is in like lots, he's on it. This is a big week for Tom.
All week, yeah. He's in like 40 things.
Exactly. Yeah. No, so if you like Tom Skerritt, this is the week to not make any plans to go out of the house because
although some things are against each other. So if you're a real Tom Skerritt fan, you got a real choice. Like, what do you do if two Tom Skerritts?
No, you become the person that invents the VCR because exactly. you need to see Tom Skerritt. Okay. I think if you research, if you Google VCRs, I think you'll see that Tom Skerritt was the motivating factor for it.
Tom Skerritt's the mother of invention. I think we've all heard that phrase.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, exactly. I was going to try to make an alien joke about mother because the computer is called mother, but there is no joke there to be had. So I will move on. And then Avengers is on at 10:30, but that may be a rerun, I think, correct?
It is. Yep. This is a rerun. This is on.
It would have to be.
Yeah. Yeah, this is although it is a Diana Rigg era. It's not the Anna Blackman era in black and white. So it's still like somewhat contemporary, but it's from I think the previous year.
Yeah, it must be because it starts at 10:30. It's an hour show, so it would have gone past 11. The other thing that I thought just of note for Saturday night was at 11:30 there is the NBC affiliates were playing Johnny Carson reruns, which I remember them doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was the thing that they did, I think, pretty much right up until Saturday Night Live started.
Carson decided he wasn't going to let them rerun the show for free anymore. So they said, we need to find something to put on that Saturday spot. So that was the impetus of it. They were like, what can we do cheaper than paying Carson for reruns?
Mm-hmm. No, you're right. And that was the first seasons of Saturday Night Live, which I recall very well, were part of the charm of it was it was so cheap and so kind of, you know, like that it, you really had the feeling that these people had just snuck into, you know, 30 Rock and it, you know, just because nobody's there at 11:30 on Saturday night and decided to like goof off in front of the camera, you know? So, you know, it's something now it's the most, you know, for the last, what, several decades,
40 years. Kind of slick.
Yeah, no, exactly. You know, it's terrifying. Obviously very slick, but back then it was that, but the very fact that yeah, this was Saturday night, 11:30, we weren't getting any sort of live specific entertainment or comedy. You were getting Johnny Carson with Edgar Bergen.
Right.
And Don Rickles. And then there's also the Joe Pyne show. And Joe Pyne was a commentator, extremely conservative, the original conspiracy theorist, bless her heart and her soul. But my mom loved him. You know, I mean, just absolutely loved him. So I saw a lot of Joe Pyne in my young life.
This episode's crazy because it's about hypnosis, and he interviews a bunch of hypnotists in 1967. Mm-hmm. So there's like, this sounds crazy. A guy named Hart Tomlinson, who calls him Bishop of the World, is a hypnotist.
this sounds about right. Yeah, this is, I think, your average show. This is, you know, it's nothing special here.
It's hypnotist, you know, Saturday. That's what he did.
Yeah, exactly. And then he would rant about communists, and then it was, and then they were out.
I'd watch it.
So now it's time. Okay, it's like 1 a.m. Time for me to collapse into bed, surrounded by my posters from Man from U.N.C.L.E. and Get Smart. And then we move on to Sunday.
Yes. And I do want to mention, just because you said 1 a.m., sure, Honey West is on at 1 a.m. on the ABC affiliate.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's actually pretty good programming. I feel like dudes up at 1 in the morning on a Saturday night in 1967 would really enjoy Honey West.
Yeah, you're right. And it depends on you as an individual, but you might want to watch 10 minutes of it, 15 minutes of it.
Yeah, like, whole thing being whatever you need, with the story.
Just whatever you need. You don't necessarily need to watch the whole thing. Yeah, it's, you know, it's like, and then let's see what else. Honey West was based on a book series, which I did not know.
I didn't know that either.
Someone I know, a friend of a friend, actually has the book rights to it and reached out to me and said, you know, would you be interested in being involved, you know, trying to get this back up off the ground? And not my genre, whatever. But yeah, I thought it was a really interesting, you know, notion at the time. It was wildly, you know.
Even now, I'm actually surprised that reboot hasn't gone. Like, this seems like a ripe time for, like, a hot blonde detective who knows kung fu and has a giant serval cat.
Yeah, no.
Greenlit right now.
Yeah, that totally. No, exactly. No, that would actually be an interesting show to go back and look at, only because it was so. It's probably, you know, yes, she ran the detective agency. She was very formidable, knew karate or whatever that was. Had the ocelot, right, and then and had a guy assistant, which is unusual. But yeah. I bet you, if we watched it today, it would still be the most freaking sexist thing.
Oh, I'm sure.
You know, it's like we would cringe through the entire thing. There, even though she's like, you know, the leader of the, you know,
be like, they tried
the lead to the show. Exactly. And then Sunday was, obviously the Sunday afternoon was the time for kind of the highbrow programming. And at 4 o'clock on Sunday afternoon, there's NBC has Experiment in Television. I would love to find this somewhere now. Okay. Because it's the title of the special of this edition is Movies in the Now Generation, most of whom are probably gone now. Okay. So, you know, author editor George Plimpton is host for this look at student filmmaking. Joining him are students who demonstrate cinema techniques, editing, animation, lighting, and camera work. Plimpton introduces student films that represent different styles. Would be very interesting to see if any of these are by, this is pre George Lucas and Spielberg and people like that, but it might be interesting, you know, it would be interesting to see. But a TV show about television would totally intrigue me.
Oh yeah. I wonder if I could find a copy of that. Cause I'm really interested to see who the directors were and if anyone ended up.
Yeah, no, exactly. Yet. So, yeah, we should, we'll get on it. And then
if anyone can find it, it's my listeners.
Okay. Well, send it along, folks.
Yep.
Ken and I are nerding out on
need to know.
this NBC experiment in television. We'll say it, the title again, just to make sure everybody gets it.
Yeah.
Movies
the one with George Plimpton, everybody. Don't get confused for any other experiments.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Really. I don't actually watch any of them, so just send it.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But then Sunday night, It's About Time. Do you remember It's About Time?
Yes. This was astronauts get trapped. It's basically Planet of the Apes, but with cavemen.
It's about time. It's about space. It's about the end of the human race. Okay. And that's all you get from me.
it was good.
Yes. No, it's astronauts who end up in caveman time, right?
To start with.
And then it was tanking. Yes. It was tanking. And so they pulled what Planet of the Apes movie series did later in the 70s, which is what? What did they do?
Let's put the cavemen or the apes in our modern world instead. Maybe that was the problem.
No. Okay. Actually, a much smarter, better premise, right? Because it's cheaper, right? Because you can actually shoot in the real world, right? And it's more interesting to see the cavemen react to, I just think, than the how many times can the astronauts, go
roll their eyes and go, ugh.
Yeah, you're eating a dinosaur and you're using rocks as a spoon, So anyway,
the thing I'll say about It's About Time is that it is the best illustration of the writing talent of Nat Hankin. And Nat Hankin didn't work on It's About Time, but Joey Ross did. And he's terrible on It's About Time, but he's amazing on Car 54, Where Are You? That Nat Hankin wrote.
No, you're absolutely right. No, I can't say that this is the best work of any of the folks in it. Imogen Coca is in it. Frank Allater, a letter, is in it.
John Mulaney. Yeah, it's not a bad cast. It's just.
No, it is. No, it's so a very good 60s. Comedy cast.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I just think it probably not the the writing probably was not up to their Sid Caesar's your sort of show, or Ned Hankin quality. Disney's on, always would watch Disney, obviously, often. That was a standard for family, obviously. And then at 8 o'clock there's Ed Sullivan, which I stand alone in that, or my family does. We didn't watch Ed Sullivan. Now I kind of wish we did.
Was it too New York-y or like it just was?
I don't know. It just didn't. We would watch Hollywood Palace on and Lawrence Welk on Saturday nights. But maybe we'd just been overly entertained. We were just maxed out on awesome musical and entertainment and comedy. Stand-up comedy. So anyway, Ed Sullivan, we never kind of got into that. Here's the FBI's on at the same time. I know we'd watch that because my dad would worked on that.
I do want to mention one quick thing about Ed Sullivan is in this episode, the Muppets are in it. And speaking of SNL, before the Muppets, Henson was still trying to find a way to do something regularly on television with the Muppets. And they would be on Ed Sullivan all the time. And then that first season of SNL, he had a segment every week for the first couple episodes before they didn't know what to do with the Muppets. So it's interesting seeing sort of those pre-Muppet Muppets on things like Ed Sullivan in 1967.
No, you're right. The very first experience I had with the Muppets that I know of was, I can't think of his name. The singer who sang Trailer for Sale or Rent. That guy. Everybody listening is screaming at their phone right now. That guy. He had a variety show. Roger Miller. Yes. He had a variety show, and Ralph, the dog character,
Ralph,
that Jim Henson did, was on that show. So that was the first time I'd seen a Muppet. Yeah, but the Muppets, they were, everybody loved them, and they did a lot of commercial work and all that. Won awards, and then along came Sesame Street, obviously, which really made them famous.
So your dad worked on FBI, but were you aware of the shows your dad worked on when they were on?
Very much so. He would walk through. He'd be watching, because he was Warner Brothers TV in the early 60s too. And we'd be watching there's all those Westerns, Bronco and Maverick and Sugarfoot and all those. And we'd be watching those, and he'd come home from work and he'd walk through and just kind of glance at the TV and go, yeah, I worked on that one. And never quite knew if it actually was the episode he worked on, but, you know, I'll give it to him. I know he worked on the series. Yeah, the FBI used to visit the set of that quite a bit. So when one of the many, 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 many joys of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, the Tarantino movie, was that, you know, he obviously remembers these eras incredibly well. And Leo DiCaprio's been, you know, his actor character is in an FBI episode with the opening credit sequence.
And it's seamless. And
But I go, did he make this movie just for me? Because it's so just, you know, it's the era of LA when I was there and you know, growing up and all that, and, you know, KFWB radio and all that sort of thing. So, so we definitely watched the FBI. Very, you know, obviously all it was the, just the, singing the merits of the FBI. Structurally, it's interesting. Again, they were among the scripts my dad would bring home to me were FBI scripts. And even at an early age, I kind of realized that they spend a lot of time with the guest stars and the bad guys. So even though they're bad guys, you get to know them really well. And then it was almost like at the end of every act, suddenly here comes Erskine, is played by Ephraim Zimbalist, you know, and the FBI guys to kind of chase after them and talk to some suspects or places that they've been. And then at the end, they end up gunning down or whatever they do to the bad guys. But you get to know the bad guys better because you spend more time with them. And I'm sure it was a wonderful, Ephraim Zimbalist loved to play tennis. So I'm sure it was a great gig for him because, you know, he probably worked 2 days a week, maybe, you know.
Write more scenes for that Robert Blake kid, and then we'll shoot him.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, Bobby Blake's in it, which is terrific. I'm sure he was a joy on the set. Not a problem at all on the FBI. John Larch, who's an actor who's terrific. He's in Dirty Harry movies and stuff like that. So, you know, and again, I think John Larch is just new to show up, you know, at the lot, and they aimed him at, you know, whatever show they wanted because he knew he was going to be working that day, that week. So, you know, he just goes, okay, which show?
Murderers. We need murderers on stage four. Yeah.
You're Fred Wallace. Get in front of the lights. Yeah. Go. Action.
In Endless Summer is on, which is one of my favorite documentaries. I'm actually surprised that it's on because it's only from 1966. And it lists it as being on pay TV. And I'm like,
I was going to say, you see where it is.
Yeah, pay TV in 1967, and it actually says you'd pay $1.50 to watch it. But I'm like, how the hell did you order that?
Yeah,
I have no idea.
You just put the money on the nightstand. You know,
the guy shows up with an 8mm reel for you.
You start watching it. There's a knock at your door.
Yeah,
I don't know. I don't think it. I'm guessing not Apple Pay.
No,
that's just a wild guess. That's probably not the way you pay for it. I remember being in line at a movie, maybe around this era, maybe a little bit earlier. And there's someone going up and down the line with a clipboard with a petition to sign in favor of pay TV. And my parents and I had no idea what that meant, but just the phrase pay TV sounded horrible.
Yeah.
So I'm like, why would we pay? Now suddenly they're going to make us pay for TV, right?
We're going to put quarters in it?
Yeah. No, exactly. And it doesn't even vibrate.
Right.
Little did we know that we would be missing out on Endless Summer a couple of years later.
Yeah. $1.50. And then, which is not cheap in 1967, by the way, $1.50.
No, considering movies were probably 75 cents. So, yeah, for a movie that, well, the movie is only, it was 1966, so it was only a year old.
It's pretty new.
So, and this is, so it probably was obviously not playing on in syndication yet, right?
Definitely not.
Yeah, so if you wanted to see it, if you missed it in the theaters, there's, you have a code number. So I guess,
I'm gonna have to figure this one out.
And then something that's incredibly important to me is occurring at 8:30 on Sunday night, which is a comedy special, which is called "We'll Take Manhattan," the pilot for projected series. My favorite thing on television was busted pilots.
Okay,
I loved busted pilots. I mean, not because they were busted, like I was like, you know,
yeah,
totally evilly going, yeah, these people failed, and I'm happy. You know, I was
You're
like,
fired, Dwayne scotch. Hickman.
I drank my 12-year-old person's scotch.
Cigar. Went,
yeah, that could have been me. That could have been my show. Damn it. I used to love it. I know CBS would play off their busted comedy pilots. They had on Friday nights during the summer. Sometimes
yeah, CBS play, Summer Playhouse, it would be. Yeah.
Yeah. And there would be these pilots that failed. And for whatever reason, I loved those. So yeah, here's Dwayne Hickman taking another shot at at another series. Sadly, I don't remember. We'll Take Manhattan the next season.
He tells an old Indian chief that he may be the rightful owner of Manhattan. So he plays a Native American who decides he's the rightful owner of Manhattan. And then this is the worst. The chief knows a good thing when he sees it and moves his teepee to Park Avenue for a battle against New York. I'm surprised that didn't go.
No, exactly. Dwayne Hickman, it's funny, his name does not suggest Native American to me.
No.
But he must be, because they obviously, they would certainly in 1967, they would not have, you know, just wantonly cast a white guy.
Of course not. In Leslie Perkins role. As Princess Laughing Brook. Leslie Perkins certainly has to be.
That's totally it. And then Chief Irontail is played by Ben Blue.
Maybe that's the closest we get. Wow.
But it probably the name Iron Tail is probably a sample of the level of humor
this
pilot, you know, attained. And then sadly, for anyone watching that week, Hey Landlord was preempted.
Yes.
Which is a show I really liked. I think that was I'm guessing it was a Gary Marshall, Jerry Belson show, I think.
That would make sense tonally. Right. It felt like that. Yeah.
Yeah. And it was the guy who played Sugarfoot, Will.
Oh, yeah.
That guy.
I can't think of his name. Yeah. But him doing comedy, which was unusual.
Yeah. Yeah. No, extremely. And I remember an episode of Hey Landlord, and okay, this is total nerdity.
We're here for.
There was a woman, he fell in love with a poster that he would walk past, an advertisement. For something. The woman in the advertisement absolutely just fell in love with this image of this woman to the point where he all he had was a nail clipper, and he used a nail clipper to cut the image out, and he put it up in his apartment. And his roommate, Sandy Baron, I forget. Anyway, his roommate was like going, "What are you doing?" Anyway, he's so obsessed with this woman that he has to go meet her. He has to find her and meet her. So he tracks her down through the ad agency. And when he meets her, she's just there's like this neurotic, you know, model. You know what I mean? I have no idea why this idea stuck with me, but I think the level of his obsession and all that was you know, kind of stuck with me for some reason. But so for those of you who were in, episode premise appealed to you, I would highly recommend you seek out Hey Landlord, because
it's very careful like what that. You wish for, sort of almost Twilight Zone twist for comedy.
Yes, no, exactly. No, it is that sort of, yeah, I think there's an actual kind of little Twilight Zone-ishness to it. So I'll take that as a way to get to try to assuage my embarrassment. and then having told that tale. Here comes Smothers Brothers.
Yep.
Nancy Sinatra and Frank Sinatra Jr., the two kids are on together.
Yep. Dom DeLuise.
Pat Paulson's in there. Nelson Riddle Orchestra.
Yep. Yes,
I think this was the pre-wild Smothers Brothers era. Bonanza, always watch Bonanza. A total biggie for us.
Did you ever work on a Western?
No. I mean, that's so outside of my genre. Yeah, I would love to have. There just aren't a lot of Westerns either. So
no, there really isn't. I guess you have to, you know, I always say that Star Trek was a Western, and sort of all Westerns later were basically sci-fi series, but the same sort of format and premise. Mm. But it is interesting to me, all the people that grew up when Westerns were the prominent genre, like 70% of the shows on TV were Westerns. Mm. No, almost nobody went on to make Westerns themselves.
Yeah, well, because they just fell out of favor, you know what I mean? And I think you're right. I think Certainly Star Trek is the prime example of, you know, using the wagon train to the stars, which was Roddenberry's way of describing it when he would pitch the series originally, was kind of eclipsed it. And we may have just maxed out on it. You know, yeah. Just it may have been too much. I think they were at the time and less expensive too.
Because they own the lots and all the sets were kind of
pre-built. Own the lots. And that may be a factor too, that all those lots got, you know, bulldozed. You shot outside a lot. So there wasn't a lot of, you know,
saving on lighting.
Yeah. No, that is a factor. Okay. It's sad, but you know, you work a lot faster, you know.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Although unless you were Gunsmoke, which had their main town set on stage. So it used to drive my dad crazy because he goes, look at their feet. And even though they're outdoors, there was they had four different shadows. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because obviously they were lit from multiple sides by.
There's a planet with four suns.
Okay. They just let us kind of discover that on our own.
That was right? Canon. You know? A lot of people didn't know.
Yeah.
That was the big twist at the end.
That was the pitch. If your series was going to be canceled, your Western was going to be canceled, you'd go to the network and say, no, you don't understand. We have to have another season because this is because, yeah, this,
they're on big reveal. That's right. And then Monday, what'd you do?
Monday, I would be forced to go to school, you know, damn them.
Which is a shame.
Yeah. And then Monday we would, getting into the, I don't see, I was looking for it because I wasn't sure in 1967 if Steve Allen used to have a syndicated show in the afternoons.
Yeah. It was not like 4 o'clock. It was on the Merv Griffith kind of time, right?
Yeah.
Like 3 or 4 o'clock.
And yes, exactly. And it had a couple different incarnations and I just didn't see it here. So it may not have started yet, but it was to me, Steve Allen was just the, you know, whatever, I shouldn't say this because I am not funny, but whatever level of humor I might
differently,
have
but
or aspire to. Okay. What it was, would, you know, was certainly influenced in a huge way by Steve Allen. He's just fantastic. So anyway, I was hoping to see, and I've tried to find, you know, versions of his show on YouTube and things like that, and haven't been able to find it yet.
For people that don't know, it was basically what Letterman's show was like in the 80s.
Yes.
It was very similar.
Letterman did a lot of Steve Allen started the Tonight Show. He had invented the entire format back in the early 50s, and then had primetime and did a bunch of stuff. And then in the late 60s and into the 70s, he had this syndicated show and just incredibly wild stuff. And he was really funny and very smart, you know.
Very quick.
Super quick. And discovered a lot of really, really, really funny people. I remember he had Bob Einstein on once. And Bob Einstein would come on as different, you know, as like other kinds of guests. So he brings him out as like he's a real guest who was raised by wolves.
Right? Oh, yes.
So, so they do like 3-4 minutes about being raised by wolves. And it's all very straightforward and real, right? And then they bring out another guest who does little desk sculptures. And the thing that they work on fire hydrants is one of the things that they like to model. And so they spring out and start putting fire hydrants in front of Bob Einstein. I'm laughing now and it's not even,
yeah,
it
doesn't, we're already seeing funny where it's in the going. Yeah.
But it's Bob Einstein, you know, just trying not to look at them, but looking at them. And it's the sort of thing that his brother Albert Brooks did brilliantly, those sorts of things on The Tonight Show, you know, where it's a great setup gag that, you know, isn't just it's not a joke, it's not telling jokes.
They just let it burn. Premise. It just is this slow burn, like just it almost painfully keeps going.
It's just so good. And Einstein was just so deadpan, was fabulous. So anyway, so that's so much for a show that isn't even in the TV Guide.
Yeah.
And then here's an interesting on Monday night, there's interesting Monkees is on, obviously, yep. A show that for my older sister, teenager at the time, was like her absolute favorite. I remember the show would end and she goes, I wish there was another one on right now. And I said, you've just invented streaming.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
More Monkees.
Exactly. And then Gilligan's Island is on, which may in fact be a rerun, I think, too. But anyway, there's at 8 o'clock, there's Mr. Terrific and Captain Nice.
Yes.
Which I'm not sure if they were both on. I think they were on the same time, right?
Mr. Terrific's on at 8 and Captain Nice is 8:30.
Right. I mean the same.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Okay. Two different networks, too.
Right. Oh, yeah. No, that's just it. Because you can't, when a good idea hits the zeitgeist, boy, you can't be sure that some other network's not going to, do the exact same thing. So for those of you, the couple of you out there who don't happen to know what these shows are, they're both shows that were satires on superheroes. So, Mr. Terrific was a guy who the lesser known Stephen Strimple, I hope I pronounced that right, was, played Mr. Terrific, who was a nerdy guy who ended up with, I forget what his powers are. You may remember, Ken.
They would change depending on the plot. It would be that kind of thing. Very Superman-esque. Like it was kind of flying, that sort of stuff.
Yeah, no, but it's basically that. And then the better show, if and I use that term, advisedly, was Captain Nice, which came from Buck Henry, did come from Buck Henry. Had Bill Daniels in it, Alice Ghostly, and so kind of some Get Smartish kind of people. But Captain Nice was the wittier show. Thank you, Buck Henry. And if you can find it, I think it might be on YouTube, the pilot or the beginning of the pilot for Captain Nice. And it looks like it cost a fortune because I forget exactly what happens, but something happens and the entire front of a building falls away. So you see people in there bathing and people like,
it's not stock footage. Like you're like, they've written to this. Yeah.
Yeah. So, they had a lot of faith in this premise. And I remember that, he called himself Captain, just Captain Nice is funny, I think.
Yes.
It's because his name was, the character's name that Bill Daniels played was Carter Nash.
Yes.
And it was the initial CN. So they saw a CN on his belt buckle because we all have initials on our belt buckles.
Yeah. And so we don't misplace our belts.
Yeah, exactly.
We're that's always right. mixing them up.
as long as you're, well, I do check when I go to the restaurant, I do check mine at the door. So I have walked away with other people with the same initials as mine
all the time,
from there. Exactly. Yeah. So it does happen. Anyway, he had, that was why he's called Captain Nice. And then Andy Griffith's on at 9 on, and it's in color. So this is the post Barney era.
But not the RFD era yet.
The waste of Ken Berry.
Era. Yeah. Ken Berry era.
Yeah. It was a great paycheck for Ken, I'm sure, but kind of a waste of his incredible talents. Let's see what else. Felony Squad, another cop show. A lot of cop shows. And these are what's interesting is Felony Squad was a half hour, and I'm always interested in half hour dramas. I wish they'd bring them back. I mean, they do some streaming does versions of, but not half hour a regular series. They'll do like Black Mirror. They'll do
anthologies
in a half hour. Yeah, and I think half hours to me is the perfect length for an anthology episode. If I may, but
when you were working on the new Twilight Zone, which I think was like your second or third gig, probably, right?
My very first. No, it's the very.
It was the first.
First writing job. Yeah.
The weird thing about that was the episodes didn't fit a half hour format, right? Like sometimes they do a story that was like 10 minutes and then another one. And then like, a 20 minute in a half hour.
Yeah, no, it was an hour show. But we would do however many or length segments we wanted to, which sounds incredibly, good. It sounds good because, boy, the story has as long as it needs to tell, right? But at the end of the day, I think it was just disconcerting to the audience because you're used to getting things delivered in certain, divisions of 15-minute chunks, right? And you didn't know if you didn't know if you were watching a segment and it wasn't really working for you. You didn't know if this is going to be like the 10 minute one, right?
Right.
Or is this going to be one of the is this going to be freaking 40 minutes? and or you're watching one you really like and suddenly there's a, you know, it was a surprise ending and you go, oh, that was over. So we did get a second season on that. And there was a lot of talk about how to, you know, kind of rework it so that they were 2 half hours. So everybody knew that they'd be 2 half hours. And I think it would kind of ultimately, the powers that be decided, let's just stick with what we're doing. I don't think that would have saved us even that. But it was a weird kind of experimental thing to do. But we took a shot.
Because the two episodes that you wrote that come up on the show often are Shadow Man, which I think Joe Dante directed, if I'm remembering right.
Yes, he did. Yeah, absolutely.
And so many people I know who saw that as kids, like that particular episode, like stuck with them forever.
Like that's true. No, that's great.
It taps into the, it's funny and has like that childhood thing and the twist is great. And then the other show that I always bring up on this show is Wordplay, because the intersection of comedy and horror is something that fascinates me. So the two things I recommend to people is, I'm like, read Dance Macabre, the Stephen King book. It's about horror, but everything he writes in it applies to comedy. It's just a different payoff. And Wordplay, because it's such a good example of, you never change the premise in that, but it starts off funny and becomes terrifying.
No, that's great. No, I'm so glad to hear you say that. Yeah. And I got to tell you that, you know, we'd go in and this was back in the day when you'd go into a screening room to watch the dailies. You know, you didn't get them streaming to you over your laptop. But we'd go to dailies and just, we howled because it was just so funny to see these people, saying the words all wrong and out of order. The words I was consistent in the words. You know, I mean, if a certain word was substituting for something else, you know, it actually, you know, I went to the effort to right. do that.
Dinosaurs dinner every time.
Yeah. And those, it's interesting. That's really exactly. It really is interesting that those are the two that you mentioned, because that literally is the very beginning of my career. I'd written Wordplay as a spec script for a Twilight Zone-like anthology that had been on a few years earlier called Dark Room.
Oh, yes. James Coburn.
ABC. Yeah, James Coburn, you know. And I'd written it for that as a spec and actually managed to get it into the producers of that show, Peter Fisher, Peter Fisher of Murder, She Wrote fame. And he was very kind and wrote back and said, this is actually really good, but we just got canceled. Right. When they brought back Twilight Zone, they're bringing back Twilight Zone and also Amazing Stories. We submitted my agent at the time, a really sweet old little lady, was the only person that would be willing to take me on as a client. She submitted it to both shows and we ended up selling it to Twilight Zone. And then I went in and pitched other story ideas, and Shadow Man was the story that I pitched that they bought. So literally the first two things I ever that I ever wrote, and it's all been a bumpy road since.
I mean, that's a high bar to set though. Like they're very, very good.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. No, I'm tremendous fun. And the very fact that Robert Klein played the lead in that first one. And I was a huge fan of his at the time. The frustrating thing for me was literally when we were just about to start shooting that first episode, there was a writer's strike.
Right.
So I wasn't allowed to go on the set. So not that the writer is ever needed on the set.
But it's your first chance to go. Like
yeah, I could have been on the set and been, you know, like that. So didn't, yeah, you know, that missed that opportunity. So dang that writer's guild.
But so for an anthology, like you know, you have those ideas. They're very great twist ideas and work very well in an anthology. When you write stuff for a series, do you still get sort of twist ideas like that, but you have to reverse engineer them into the series?
That's a good question, because you're not really working to twist. The twists often for me come in the middle of the piece. You know what I mean? I'm looking for a twist essentially for act breaks, if you will, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think that my love of Twilight Zone in general and my work on the show probably put me in good stead to kind of do that, to look for those things, those sorts of moments in the body of the story, less so as the button to an episode, because that's kind of very much the Twilight Zone domain, and you kind of want the twist in the midst of it so that you then get to, you know, it's like
it's an escalation reaction to it. Right.
Yeah, exactly. You know, so I think that's interesting. For the most part in my experience since then, that's kind of where they come.
Where are we? Tuesday?
Moving on to Tuesday. Also, there's a giant ad here for a hearing aid company.
Yes, and it's so offensive.
Yeah. Don't be deaf.
Like, can you imagine like an ad for a wheelchair company? Like, don't be sitting there. Like, is there any other issue someone has?
Yeah. Don't waste your shoes.
Right. You know? Don't be blind. Get these glasses. Yeah. Like, it's so weird.
No, exactly. But what's also interesting about the ads in general is they're all so Mad Men like. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
You know, they're just so, like, you could just picture the admin on Madison Avenue, like, coming up with these things and how they're just trying to kind of sell you on this stuff in a way that's, like, totally that era.
Like, I can picture this on a whiteboard and a guy with a, you know, a pointer being like, and then the arrow and the action goes here. Like, it's so laid out like that.
Okay. I got three words for you. Don't be deaf.
Okay. You know, it's like, brilliant.
Okay.
Love it. Okay. Right to the point.
Yeah, exactly. Bring me. Let's go have our three martini lunch.
Yep.
And celebrate. And then I also noticed in just talking about in late night, Johnny Carson, obviously, which they list as Johnny Carson, not as Tonight.
As the Tonight Show, yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. And then Joy Bishop. This is obviously the era when Joy Bishop, ABC, was taking a shot at you know, trying to counter program Johnny, and they put on Joey. And
it's a Jay, he's a Rat Pack guy, kind of, you know, it'll work.
He can stay up late, I think, you know. Anyway, okay, so moving on to Tuesday. Just another TV guide thing, which I find is interesting, is they would always have TV close-ups, which I always like, where they do a blow up on like a quarter of a page about some show they wanted to highlight. It's interesting because there's so many of them are like the smart stuff, you know what I mean? So there's, I think coming up, there's something about Mark Twain and whatever, we'll get to that. But this night on Tuesday night at 10 o'clock, if you were so inclined, there's a national science test.
Yes.
The laws of science are not restricted to space centers and laboratories. They're involved in everything from moon launches to kicking a football. This test gauges your scientific knowledge and covers your opinions on science's new frontiers. So, you know, that's something that if you just can't sleep.
Right.
And
you can expand your mind.
Yeah, exactly. So I jump on this. Don Herbert was on this, who was formerly TV's Mr. Wizard.
Yep. And then again in the 80s when Nickelodeon brought him back as Mr. Wizard, which that show, he's so angry and old, and it's shot in Canada, so these kids are extra polite. So it's basically just Don Herbert yelling at Canadian kids. Like, there's one I always bring up. There's this nice little kid in there. Don Herbert's trying to teach him about water displacement. So he just keeps shoving this kid's head into a bucket. Like, this kid's in like a big oil barrel full of water. And he's like, so what happened, Eugene, when I put you down there? Well, the water came. Get back down there. He's just like shoving this kid.
Oh, okay. I love it. I think you remember that as actually happening, because there was the Pat Paulson show, right?
Yes.
That they did after the summer, right? And they had one of the recurring sketches was a Mr. Wizard kind of guy, right? Where Pat Paulson was Mr. Wizard,
yes.
And he had the two teenagers on. I remember Bob Einstein was one of them, and he kept hitting on the girl,
yes,
the high school girl, and tried to, you know, and at the meantime, they put Bob Einstein. Hook him up to the electrodes
and trying to get rid of
how electricity works. So exactly. Yeah. So I think you might be misremembering.
I wish that I were, for the sake of those Canadian kids. I wish I were, but I don't think so.
So Tuesday, now I'm way behind on my homework. Okay. Cause I didn't do any homework Monday night when I should have.
That's all right.
And here comes the girl from Uncle.
And a great one with Boris Karloff.
I know. Yeah.
As Mother Muffin.
Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, Yeah, no.
He's in drag.
I can picture him in the outfit. Yes, I can picture him in the outfit. I don't know why. I think it's etched in my brain in a not good way. Yeah, no. It's when I die, I think that's the image I'll have.
That's your deathbed image. It's Boris Karloff as Mother Muffin.
Yeah, exactly.
Rockne's last words were Mother Muffin.
Yeah, you know, my kids are confused. I love to mess with my I never should have had kids because I just love messing with them. So yeah, the idea that my last words are Mother Muffin. Well, that would be the thing I would do. So okay, nobody tell him.
I won't tell him. No, we want to surprise him. Yeah,
I need, yes, exactly. So because that's going to be awesome. But yeah, what for me, a big Man from U.N.C.L.E. fan, the original Man from U.N.C.L.E. fan, and the bummer for me with Girl from U.N.C.L.E. was it was too goofy, it was too silly. Man from U.N.C.L.E. kind of turned that way. First season, it had its tongue to me properly in cheek,
like the Avengers kind of vibe.
Yes, exactly. Yes, I but it was more as a kid. I could enjoy it more as a James Bond, for TV sort of thing. And then it started to get kind of self aware and, if I may, kind of ashamed of itself.
Well, they tried to compete with Get Smart. It's a really weird instance of the parody show doing better than the sincere one. So the sincere show tries to be more like the parody of itself, which I can't think of any other examples like that.
It's a horrible mistake. And because Get Smart is meant to be funny.
Right.
If you're trying to be, so they're trying to walk some sort of line. So anyway, Girl from U.N.C.L.E. was just too, and it was very off the cuff. They're, the acting style between the two of them. Just seemed to me, I liked them both. I think they're both,
Yes, Stephanie Powers is great.
Stephanie Powers is fabulous. And then Noel Harrison played her. And this Robert Vaughn guested on this one, and I guess in an attempt to, dial up the ratings, but didn't quite work the magic I think they were hoping. And then there were shows, Red Skelton was on. I used to watch that, enjoyed that, very corny, but
very broad.
But it was just, you would never turn the TV off,
Right. So, well, that would be insane.
It's the least objectionable television was the tattoo I have on my arm. And then a show called Occasional Wife, which I do with Mickey Callen or Michael Callen, who just passed away recently. And I do remember that too. And I just, the premise of an occasional wife, is to me,
it was like,
it's
just sexy, only sometimes,
but it's not really, they don't really, will they?
Well, it was
they,
like a proto Three's Company. Like he hired this sort of like hippie beatnik girl to be his fake wife so he could get a job at this business, like this. Wasn't a law firm, but it was like a business where they're like, we only have executives that are married, like some weird thing like that. Mm-hmm. Very, very weird show.
Right. And Dharma and Greg too, kind of, right?
Yes, because he was he was not explicitly not heterosexual, but it was pretty obvious when you watched the show. Yeah, I've revisited that recently, and it's more interesting than I remembered it being. Some intentional and some probably not.
Yeah, see, that's the show I would watch. Like I said, if I was trying to pick things that I would watch now, I would certainly watch that simply for the nostalgia of it. You know what I mean? I may not make it through a whole episode, but I would certainly watch it for that reason because I would love to kind of revisit it. But then at the same time, I would have to have to watch The Invaders.
Yeah, Larry Cohen.
Yeah, which is absolutely, totally. And Harlan Ellison, I think, was on it briefly. I think he worked on that.
Second season, I think he did, yeah.
And if you notice, here comes Julie Summers again.
Yep.
This is Julie's her second appearance this week on TV.
No Tom Skerritt.
Ed Asner. No. Hold on, Tom's coming. And Peggy Lipton plays the bride.
Yep, Burgess Meredith.
She's a star waiting to happen, and Buzz Meredith. Invaders definitely would watch. Love that. Interesting that it was a Quinn Martin production because Quinn was the producer. Quinn Martin was more the meat and potatoes guy, right?
Oh, yeah.
FBI and things like that. And Cannon, I think, was his and things like that. So the very fact that he went kind of off the reservation into Invader land.
Yeah, it was kinda, like, for people that don't know, it was kind of the Fugitive with aliens, sort of.
Yeah. Roy Thinnes is out, and I think he was driving home on a dark road somewhere and fell asleep at the side of the road, and then an alien craft landed, and then he had spent the rest of the episodes trying to convince people that there were invaders. Do you remember why? How you could identify an invader?
I don't. I totally forget.
Their pinky, their pinky finger would extend out.
Oh, that's right. They were classy. That's how you knew.
Yes, exactly. So if you went to a high tea, you couldn't tell who was who. Okay,
you're all but
other
aliens.
Than that, yes. And in the pilot episode, an invader. I'm sure there were others, but an invader was Ellen Corby. Years later, I worked at Lorimar, and as a production assistant, they'd have screenings every week, and I'd sit next to Ellen often at the screenings. And it was like, every time I sat next to her, in the back of my mind, I was aware that she had been an alien in the, in invaders. I didn't
just staring at her pinky.
She actually was. Yeah. No, but I showed great restraint by not totally geeking out on her and going, you were the invaders and the pilot. And
it is hard to do sometimes. Like, they're like, I'm pretty good about playing it cool for the most part, and then I'll freak out later if I've worked with somebody. But there are some people you're taken aback at how you react sometimes, especially people you watched in your childhood where you're like, wow, I didn't expect to react that way.
Oh yeah. No, I have zero filter in that regard. I just totally geek out on people. There's certain ones that I just hold in abeyance that I go, okay, if I ever meet this person, I will definitely be saying this. And I'm sure there's many. The only one that comes to mind, this is not a good, great one, but Barbara Boson, who was, in Hill Street Blues and all that. She's a nurse in the movie Bullet, where Robert Vaughn comes in and says, I need to speak to so-and-so. And she goes, I'll get him for you or something, and stands up. So things like that, where I just hold these things in the back of my head so that if I ever met, she passed away, but if I met, I would go, you were great in Bullet,
She'd go,
exactly. Yeah. Or Judd Hirsch in Serpico.
Oh yeah.
Things like that. So,
or the night they saved Halloween, where he plays Dracula.
Yeah, no. They shouldn't let us loose. You and I need to be. We really do need to show restraint.
And I do want to mention,
there must
be
some medication.
Oh yeah, I've tried them. At 7:30, the Twilight Zone rerun is The After Hours, which is one of the episodes, the few original series episodes that the new Twilight Zone remade. And I think you wrote the script for that one.
I did write. I did that. I did a couple of the remakes. I also did the Christmas one.
Oh, Night of the Meek?
Called the title. Yes. Is that the, yes. The yeah, one that the was
Art Carney one originally. Yep.
Right. And I did that one. But After Hours, I did the remake of that one. Turned out okay. It wasn't, direction wasn't fabulous. The thing I was very proud of, the thing I was able to add, which I think made it a little bit more horrific, if you will, in the latter part, the young woman. It's a story. It's a woman goes into a department store, and then they fall asleep, or I forget what it is, but she ends up there after hours, after the thing's closed.
It has a Carnival of Souls suddenly, kind of vibe. Like, that's kind of the...
Yeah, and then some of the mannequins come alive, right, and chase her or track her down. And then at the end, spoiler alert, they tell her, no, you're a mannequin and you were let out for a week, but now it's your turn to stand still. And now other people, one of the rest of us will go out. And I was very proud of the scare. I just added a bunch of really big scares of how they're chasing her. And then literally seeing her start to turn plastic body part by body part, which I thought was horrific and particularly interesting. And there was a great thing that we did, which was she goes by and there's body parts hanging from the wall, but then so they're just disembodied mannequin parts. And one of the hands would reach out to her. And then she looks in a barrel of mannequin heads. And then we, had a couple of actors in there facing forward so that they would open their eyes. And so it was a whole head. Those sorts of things are just obviously fun to kind of conceive of. So anyway, that was my After Hours.
And speaking of Albert Brooks in the Twilight Zone movie in the opening scene with him and Dan Aykroyd. That's one of the episodes that Albert Brooks is recounting. He goes, the one where she's a mannequin. And then, and it's so, it's really like, I'm like, I'd watch a show where Albert Brooks just recounts plots to Twilight Zone episodes.
Oh, that's the greatest opening.
Look at that old man.
And then he goes, it sounds like something on CBS. Okay. It's just absolutely floored me because it's like, it does. He's totally right. Anyway, geekdom. It's a disease.
Wednesday?
Tuesday, real quick, just back to Tuesday because I'm anal retentive and need
to
mention all of them. They're rerunning Fame is the Name of the Game, which was the pilot for the TV series Name of the Game.
Oh, okay.
Name of the Game was a one of those universal wheel shows, right? That was about a magazine company, right? Gene Barry was, so the wheel would be Gene Barry, Tony Franciosa, and it wasn't Doug McClure. I'm trying to remember who the third one was. But anyway, and so there would be different stories about Robert Stack, I think it was. And okay. they would each do a 90-minute, they'd do six or whatever it was, episodes a year, and then they would just intersperse them throughout. And then Gene Barry played the head of the publisher, the main guy. And there was an episode of that show of Name of the Game that where he just is coming from a pollution conference on air pollution, and crash out in the boonies, and he crashes his car, and he wakes up and he's in the future, and he's taken and he's taken underground because the air topside has been so polluted that everybody lives underground. And it's just very weird. And they literally do where it's hippies are now like in their 70s, right? So there are people that are wearing tie-dyed and, you know, singing kind of like, you know, those sorts of things. And that episode of Name of the Game, it's called LA 2017, was directed by a young filmmaker who was working at Universal at the time. And that filmmaker is
Spielberg,
Mr. Steven Spielberg.
That makes sense.
So Steven, there's some sci-fi ish kind of stuff in it. Obviously he's working on a low budget. Yeah. I think that may be on YouTube.
I've never seen that. I'm going to check that out.
I'm surprised you're not familiar with it.
Mentioning it now, I remember hearing it mentioned that he directed that, but I'd never seen it. I confuse that with that show, The New People, I think from the early 70s. Well,
New People was Rod Serling's
which
show,
was Rod right? Serling. Yeah. Which was totally different. For some reason, I'm like conflating them in my head.
New People is Lost, was like Lost.
Yes.
It was a young people who were, you know, get plane wrecked or shipwrecked or something wrecked, and then have to try to create a new society, you know, without
their like Lord parents. Of the Flies sort of thing. Like or what's the Corman movie where like everyone over 30 dies, and then it's like, is it Wild in the Streets?
Something America, something or
maybe it's in the 60s. Oh no, I think it's called Gas, like with like 10 S's.
Oh, okay.
But it's like this weird, like youth gone wild, like sort of juvenile delinquent movie. But the premise is like everyone over 30 dies from some virus or something. And so it's all like, those all kind of blur in my head. But looking at the cast on this, Fame is the Name of the Game, like Jack Klugman, Joel St. John, Susan St. James, Tony Francisca, who was a big star for a while. And then kind of just like this, the last thing I remember him doing was a Dario Argento movie and Robert Duvall.
I know. Well, Duvall showed up in all sorts of things. He was working actor. He's like Outer Limits, and you know. You can find him around quite a bit. As we complete our national science test on Tuesday,
yes,
and it's like, Mom, let me go to bed. It's too much like school. Now we move on. We move on to Wednesday. And let's see what's cooking on Wednesday. We got Lost in Space and Batman. So that's a toughie. It's a real tough one. Lost in Space got kind of lost its mooring a bit. And Batman, I think, might have been pretty new then. So I think I probably would be watching Batman.
This was the first season of Batman still. It's the second half of the first season. This is part two of a King Tut episode with Victor Bruno. I actually had to, like, this almost came to blows. I was working a convention and I was interviewing Mark Goddard from Lost in Space. And Adam West was there, and they were on a show together called The Detectives, and I mentioned it, and then Goddard was like, West, and then Adam West was like, I made that show better, and then they started getting, like, yelling. First of all, the convention was in an abandoned JCPenney, which makes it even weirder, but so it was Adam West and Mark Goddard, like, yelling across this JCPenney at each other, and I learned that Goddard felt like Lost in Space, he was the star of the first season. He claims, you know, it was a real black and white, real hard sci-fi show. And then because Batman 66 did so well and was against them, they changed Lost in Space to be a kid's show about the Doctor and the dumb robot. So he blamed Adam West for this. And I had to, like, mediate this between the two of them. It was the weirdest thing.
with the racks of clothes between you, right?
Yeah, you're, they were
to,
like, push,
you roll the racks between them to try to keep them from.
It was that kind of thing where it's like, out. Oh, are they buddies and they're just busting each other's balls? But I'm like, oh no, he's mad. He's legitimately mad about this.
When you started the story, I thought that was it. I thought, you know, I was kind of hoping that they were like, just, this is fun.
You're yeah,
kind of like faking
like grumpy this, old men kind feud, of thing.
But no, it's not. No, it's just two not happy actors. Somebody pointed out to me, and I should have probably realized this myself. But speaking of how seminal this era of television was for me, someone pointed out to me once that there's Lost in Space, and then I did a show called Farscape, which is about a guy who's lost in space. Okay, and then I also did, and then there's also Irwin Allen also certainly did A Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea.
Yep,
and I did a show called Seaquest, which is about a big submarine. Somebody goes, you know, you're recreating, you're the new Irwin Allen or whatever, and yes, that's. Look, I loved his shows, but I mean, that's kind of sent me to bed for a while.
no one wants to be the new Irwin Allen, even though, like,
it's not a bad thing.
Even if you weren't consciously doing that, that reminds me of, like, it's not exactly a one-to-one, but one of my favorite quotes from David Cronenberg is when he made The Fly, a reporter was like, oh, is this your favorite movie? Is that why you're remaking it? This is the best movie ever. And he said, no, it's a terrible movie. But what you do is you remake a great premise that didn't live up to its potential in execution. He goes, it's a brilliant premise. And it didn't, you know, with a bad execution or not as good as it could have been. That's why you remake a movie. And I was like, yeah. That's
okay. Well, no, okay. Yes, I agree with that sentiment, right? I don't agree with it. Look, I love I think his Fly is really good, right?
It's great.
Obviously, it's a better movie. But the original Fly is really, you know, it's really strong. Okay. Yes. As I say, since I didn't realize I was channeling Irwin Allen.
Right. It's not a conscious thing.
Yeah, no, exactly. So somehow Land of the Giants I missed. I guess I need to
There's still time.
Complete the trifecta.
Next season.
Yeah. No, exactly. So let me work on that. See if I can find a
time tunnel.
Tomato somewhere.
Done time tunnel too.
Yeah. Yeah. Trying to think of a time. I must have done. On Farscape, we've done a lot of time.
Yeah, episodes, but I don't think of time travel. No, specific. Nothing specific.
Yeah, time travel is really hard. So
yes,
So therefore, I avoided it. Giant submarines is easy.
Fringe, I think, did time travel well. If you watched Fringe at all, because they did a great episode called White Tulip with Peter Weller, and it was his consciousness could travel back to his own self. So it wasn't like physically, like his consciousness now would be in his body from like 10 years ago. Like it was that kind of, it was very interesting.
That's kind of fun. It just sounds very wish fulfillment like too, right?
Yes.
You know, we'd all kind of wish we could go back with our current awareness and whatever.
And that was the thing. His wife was killed in this car accident and he kept going back trying to change it. And he needed these enormous amount of power to do this thing. And it was hurting people around. So it was like, they were trying to stop him, but it was, that idea was very interesting to me.
That's a show I should revisit.
It's great.
I watched the first couple episodes and liked it. And then I think I started a show of my own or something, and it just, which totally just sucks up all your time.
Actually, Evil reminds me a lot of it in the best ways, where the tonally and the A story and B story really being incredibly complementary to each other. And yeah, it's, I love it.
That's great. Yeah. That's what I need to revisit. I want to rewatch X-Files too. That's one that I haven't seen in a while. And that's, it's fun because if you haven't watched something, obviously in a, you know, long enough time, you still vaguely remember them, but it's also, you're getting to experience them, what, you know, what, yet again. So, yeah, those are two that I want to revisit. Wednesday is also, obviously we've got your meat and potatoes television. The Virginian didn't watch that. Wasn't, nah. Not that it's bad, but just, didn't
grab. You westerned out.
Monroe's. We did watch the Monroe's, which, we liked. My sisters and me, because it, obviously it's about a young family, right? I think the parents are gone, right? They died or something. So it's
the older.
It's the kids who are the teenish kind of kids who have to, you know, run the ranch themselves and deal with the evil neighbors who are trying to
steal the farm, you
know, steal their land, and rustlers, and basically anybody played by Ed Asner.
Yes,
just come back every week with a different hat on. Or John Daner also is a regular villain, different names. Beverly Hillbillies is on. Again, my dad being a rural guy, kind of like those things in Green Acres.
I love Green Acres.
Green Acres has a certain wit to it.
Oh, it's Beverly so Hillbillies funny.
By then had kind of lost it, but Green Acres really, it's bizarrely, you know, witty. It's
surreal. Like the running jokes, like the one I always bring up is where they did an anti-Vietnam episode on the sly by having the pig Arnold Ziffel get drafted. Which I'm like, I can't believe they got away with this. And they had a running gag where Ava Gabor's character was aware of the credits. So as the credits were going, she'd mention them. She'd be like, the names are here again. It's the names. And they'd be like, what the hell are you talking about? And she'd like, and I'm so weird.
No, it's wonderfully meta. No, it's fabulous. No, it's fantastic. Yeah. And no, just a great, you know, family of characters in that too, you know.
And Eddie Albert's one of my favorite yelling actors. Like, there's certain actors that anything they yell is hilarious. And Eddie Albert's
like Mark Goddard and
yes, unlike Goddard and Adam West.
And Adam West. Yeah, yes. Yeah, exactly. He you can handle, right?
Yes. Although he was a war hero. He seemed like a tough guy. He saved like a whole ship of people single-handedly.
Well, and we should know that. Nobody knew that.
Yeah. So.
But he couldn't save the show.
No.
I don't know how many seasons it went, but
they went six seasons.
Okay, well, he did save it then. Okay.
Yeah. But nothing after that.
Yeah, no, good for him. And then another window onto how TV has changed. There's there is also at 9 o'clock Play of the Week, The Iceman Cometh with Jason Robards.
Yes.
You know, so
heavy for
those
stuff.
I don't know that or Gomer Pyle, USMC. I can't.
Maybe they're splitting their audience there. I mean, they're really splitting the audience there.
Yeah, totally. Let's see what Gomer Pyle is about. Gomer Pyle is about, let's see, a bar where a bunch of people come.
This is a measles epidemic in this episode.
Yeah, I know. I was trying to associate with Iceman Cometh. But then I did. Yeah, it's like I'm showing my ignorance of not really, you know, knowing much about the premise of the Iceman Cometh. But anyway, yes, Gomer Pyle never quite did it.
No, me either. It always seemed just too not a lot of too broad.
And then I Spy at 10, which is another show I would love to revisit because it was just a little bit too hip and mature for me. I liked The Man from U.N.C.L.E., which was for a kid was easier to digest, obviously.
Had gadgets. But,
I Spy would be in this. Yeah, exactly. No, but that's a lot of it. But I would love to watch Culp and Cosby because I did watch it a bit at the time. I love the opening title sequence and the music.
Yeah.
It was really fantastic.
Stepping aside from Cosby, who is really good on it, it's good. And it feels very ahead of its time in a lot of ways, not just because I think it was the first network show with a black lead in 1967, but it's a good, like a good 10 years before we start getting like true buddy cop stuff.
No, you're right. And Cosby also just had that super ease in front of the camera and being new to it too. You know, it very much along the lines of Eddie Murphy years later, where he just exploded in the movies, you know, in 48 hours, because he's just so at ease in front of the camera.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so appealing. And then Bob Culp obviously has that kind of good off the cuff kind of delivery and all that, which he's does in other shows and other things, or, you know, when he guest stars and things, and it kind of doesn't quite fit because the other actors aren't doing that. He's in the movie PT-109, for example, with, you know, Cliff Robertson, and his acting style, it's fine, but it kind of butts up against everybody. You know, he and Ty Harden, I don't think Ty Harden, who's also in the movie, was quite the method performer that
although that I will say that Robert Culp in The Architects of Fear, the Outer Limits episode, which is an episode that haunts me. That's one of those things I saw as a kid that sometimes I'll just randomly think about it as an adult and feel like really sad. And he's heartbreaking in that. It's so atypical from every other role I've ever seen him in, but he's just so good.
No, he's terrific. And this is a show that I would have to, I would love to find again.
It's streaming. Well, so. It's worth checking out. Like, I'd be curious to hear what you think of it.
I'll find it. Yeah, I will definitely find it, because that's when I'm in all my spare time.
Yes, exactly.
And then coming on to Thursday, we get to watch the conclusion of the Batman episode. That was just yet another, I mean, you think about Batman and just how many, how boldly different it was in so many respects. I think it invented the term camp.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Or the word camp was invented at the right time for Batman because it was that sort of thing. But to do a show that was satirical in that way, in a much broader sense, the color scheme was incredible. The very fact that they canted the camera during fights, I guess, because it was to make it less real, even less real and sort of thing.
Yeah.
I always thought it was because things were, or when they showed the villains, they were can't the camera. It was because they were crooked. I thought maybe that was the reason why.
But a live action Batman cartoon. Just,
yeah, no, absolutely. And then the Pow and Zam, you know, Zhao and things like that when they're fighting. Really, really smart. And then the idea of playing a cliffhanger over and playing 2.5 hours.
Back to
amazing.
Back. Days, back to back days, but burned out
when people weren't bold. Yeah, no, true. Yes. But, that's can be the problem that, you know, something that's that intensely hot, right? It burns, hot,
twice as bright,
can burn out. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, exactly. The great thing too, is that West is also, and you know, everything he ever did, he's one of those actors that, you know, Leslie Nielsen, I always say, is hilarious until people told him he was funny. And then he started trying to be funny in movies and it's terrible. Yeah. But Adam West always got the deadly serious play it straight is absolutely hilarious. And it's so well done, Batman.
No, you're absolutely right. No, you got any. And it was exactly that tone that made when they brought in Batgirl, for example, Yvonne Craig, you know, perhaps a wonderful person, right? Didn't think she was particularly strong necessarily, you know, as an actor, but also didn't have the tone. She came in just very, it was very straightforward. It's sort of like Green Hornet, which I think is coming up on Friday, but was also just done straight. It wasn't in the Batman style. And I'm not sure that it would have worked in the Batman style. I don't know. We needed another version with just a different, you know, a masked hero.
It's the same show.
But it totally didn't work. You know, as you know, and I was so hyped for Green Hornet.
Yeah.
It just was not what I wanted.
Well, it also suffered from the fact that you're watching this show and you're like, why isn't this show about Kato? Like, it was the most interesting thing.
It's so true. It's so funny. No, it's like, oh, it's the movie, the movie about Bruce Lee.
Dragon.
Yes. Where the other, you know, they portray the Green Hornet guy going, go Kato, you go do that. And, you know, then Bruce Lee just kicks ass for a minute. You know,
it's like the car and Kato.
Probably like that.
Like, that's how we want to do. Actually, that was the only scene I really had a problem with in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood was the Bruce Lee scene, because it just rubbed me the wrong way. I was just like, he was a cocky guy, kind of had to be. I don't understand why the scene's in the movie, but it might just be.
No, you're right. I agree with you. I understand what you're saying. But I just take a step back and just enjoy it as, because Tarantino so just likes to make history his own.
Right.
And he certainly does that at the end of that movie and, you know, at the end of Inglourious Basterds. So he's just making history his own, right?
Yeah.
And to portray someone we've always seen as someone who's always, you know, incredibly good at what he does, right? And all that. And it has that reputation in history and turning it on its ear. I can get into that, you know, but but I agree with you. I took it as fiction, total fiction.
Yeah.
You know, it was just giving us an
yeah, inside and like tearing the veil off the real Bruce Lee. Yeah. But it was just, it was, exactly. I was like, it rang to me like someone being like, look, Bruce Lee's had it too good for too long. It's time for somebody to come out here and say, what an asshole that guy was.
And I'm not just saying that because I know he's long dead and he can't fight back.
Do anything about it.
I would have said that if he were here.
Right, so. To his face, totally.
And then an absolute favorite is on at 8, which is F Troop.
Yes.
Which is just it's so, all the leads are great. It's the shows were good. You know, they're funny. My dad worked on that a lot. I went to visit a lot of the set of that a lot. Just everybody, you could tell everybody was just having a great time doing it too. It only lasted 2 seasons. And I believe the prevailing explanation is that I don't know if it was Warner Brothers TV was getting out of making TV. I think 7 Arts had just bought the company, and it was an expensive show, but I think they were trying to, anyway, for some reason, it was some business reason perhaps that they got out of it. But for anybody that is not familiar with F Troop, I don't want to oversell it because, you know, it is a show from
it's a goofy sitcom
like that. Yeah, it is. But anyway, and you may think otherwise, but to me, it was just it has a personal significance to me because of my kind of family connection to it. And I did bought that, you know, a couple of years ago during the pandemic to watch, and still loved it. Still thought it was really,
it's fun.
Good.
It's fun, and you can tell like the chemistry that cast has. Like Larry Storch and Forrest Tucker were in the Ghostbusters show in the 70s.
Yeah.
Just because they work so well together. Like, you almost can't imagine them acting not with each other because it just works so well on that show. Like, their chemistry is great.
No, you're absolutely right. And Larry Storch is just comedically just kind of right on. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And then Ken Berry, as I was saying before about Mayberry RFD, you know, he's fine in that. But this shows what he's really, really capable of. So it's fun to see him.
Was this a show when you visited the set, was it the kind of thing where you like asked you love the show and wanted to visit the set, or like you just happened to visit the set because your dad was working on it and then you watched it later and were like, oh cool, that's the show we visited?
No, I would go because I would just go whenever it was a holiday. So it would happen to be whatever he was working on.
Right.
So it was, you know, I didn't get to pick and choose. So visiting the FBI set, for example, was interesting because it's a set. It's an active set. But it wasn't that much fun. You know, I mean, right. However, F Troop was, you're out usually in the fort set outside. So you're outdoors in the back lot at Warner's, and it's colorful and there's horses and, you know, and uniforms. And so, and funny. And it's in there's comedy going on too. Right. And then you've got, you know, if I was lucky, I'd get there on a day that Ken Berry was doing some physical comedy bit, which was, you know, always incredibly fun to watch and watch him kind of work it out. Which he did pretty much on his own, which was impressive because he also knew what he was capable of and things that he probably had not had a lot of opportunity to do before on film. So I liked the show a lot. I thought it was really funny.
When you rewatched it over the pandemic, because a lot of people I know did that, like they had a comfort show that they revisited over the pandemic. Could you remember what episodes you saw filming?
Yes, I do. One in particular, they shot a lot of it. Because I think they shot 3 days, so one, you know, one episode in particular I remember, and you just have this kind of very vague memory of being there on the day, and there were other times that I go, wait, I remember this scene with Milton Berle, for example, was one, and there was, so you know, I mean, I would kind of remember, yeah, this looks really familiar, you know, that sort of thing.
It's so weird,
because it's been a few years, which is also, that became another fun part of it for me to watch it, was, you know,
see what memories, you know, come up. Yeah, to have that, like, that dual aspect of, so revisiting a childhood memory in two different ways.
Exactly. And then you also think, you think back, look, I was a 10-year-old or whatever, so I don't know that Milton Berle would want to talk to me, right?
Or you probably wouldn't want to talk to him. from stories I've heard of people talking to Milton Berle, you probably lucked
out.
Yes,
okay, no, granted, okay, but in terms of like the geeking out nostalgic thing of it, sure. All, right? Did you go, excuse me, Mr. Berle, can I, you know, just want to let you know I'm a big fan, and you know, yada yada, and talk to him about it being perhaps the first national television comedy star from the early 50s. I don't think that's not the sort of thing a 10-year-old would necessarily say to him.
No, no.
But that. But I'm just saying, in hindsight, that there was an episode that I saw them do with Phil Harris, who was a radio comedian, and I had no idea who he was at the time. But I've since gotten into like old radio, and he used to be on the Jack Benny Show. And just again, that's another person that I would love to have sat and talked to.
Yeah, it's so weird where you're like, I was so close, like I was there, they were there.
Yeah, and they were right there. Yeah, again, the two of them probably wouldn't take me out back and beat me up. You know,
kid.
You know, exactly. Yeah. But no 10-year-old wants to talk to Phil Harris that I know of.
You never know.
Okay, and then we're coming up on Star Trek. Here's Star Trek. I'm assuming this is first season, right? Thinking it is.
Yes, it is. Yep. Second half of the first season.
It's got Harry Mudd. Yeah, so which would have been first season. Again, it's a series that's incredibly near and dear to my heart. Incredibly smart. And, you know, you look at it now, and it's, you know, the sets and all that are all very kind of rough and tumble. But the ideas in it are fantastic. Casting is impeccable. I'm a huge Shatner fan.
He's great.
Going back to Twilight Zone and all that. So big shout out to Star Trek.
Have you seen The Invader or The Intruder with him? I think it's a Charles Beaumont script where he plays the white supremacist, William Shatner.
Yes.
So good. Like when people are like, oh, he's hammy or whatever, I'm like, you got to watch this movie because he is terrifying and just great in this movie. And it's like, I think it depends on who directed him.
Yeah, no, you're right. And no, he is terrific. He's in Judgment in Nuremberg, the movie, is just really good in it. And I mean, just, yeah, really, really good. And the Twilight Zone episodes he was in were incredibly good too. So big shout out to Bill. The Crucible with George C. Scott, just so I didn't want you to miss it.
Yeah. George C. Scott in The Crucible. He's another guy that there were so many people I interviewed on this show. After a while, it was like, should I just open every episode going, what terrible thing did George C. Scott say to you? So many stories, especially in the '80s.
When you were trying to come up with a title for the podcast, right?
Yes.
That was,
TV guidance counselor. What terrible thing did George C. Scott do to you? That was
year 20 of my show that I've never yes. ending find never stop finding people that
I would have sold it to Netflix as a series right away if I called it that. But it occurs to me too when we're talking about all these shows that these seminal shows that stuck with you and stuck with so many people, obviously, almost all of them are like two seasons. Like the ones that started in 66,
yeah.
You know, two, maybe three. So like Batman, the Monkees, you know, the shows that started in the 66, they did not last long, but ended up being the shows that had the widest influence and the longest lived fan base, which is really strange.
This is a astute observation. I guess it's not strange in that television, especially network television, is a very homogenized egalitarian entertainment, right? So things that are that specific, right, and have a more specific audience are just not going to catch the numbers that you need to have, whereas something like Bonanza, which went, you know, what, 100 seasons, I mean,
something
went,
like that, yeah, years, I think it might still be on.
No, it's and a really good show, right? But it's, you know, it's a family, you're watching regular family, you're seeing, you know, it's a milieu or genre that Western, which is very comfortable and palatable to audiences and familiar. Whereas Star Trek was this really kind of really bold experiment. The thing that I find interesting about Star Trek in general is that Roddenberry really created a show that was trying to do serious ideas and all that. But he also was very true to the large, as much as he could, to real science. Mm-hmm. So to me, the example of that is always this Enterprise, the ship, in that he talked to, you know, people who were designing ships in space, you know, for space travel, and they didn't need to be aerodynamic because they're out in space, right?
For gravity.
Yeah. So he created this thing with the image of the Enterprise that we all know and love. Subsequent series of Star Trek and the later iterations of the Enterprise became more and more slick and streamlined. You know what I mean? Simply because they're trying to make it different and also probably a little sexier, right?
Look cool,
yeah. It was the very thing that Roddenberry back in the mid-60s, when it should have been like, you know, you got to figure some NBC executives going, that's not a spaceship. You know what I mean? You know, the spaceships are sexy and pointed and it should look like a race car in space and that sort of thing. So, no, that all those things are, you know, so made it I think made it such a, you know, an important foundational, you know, program, but is also the reason why I think it probably for a broader audience is just like, this is too, too specialized. Yeah.
The people who love it really love it, but they're, you know, it's still waters run deep kind of thing. You know, it's a small pond. Yeah.
And kids didn't have that same sort of like, you know, I just had a hard day at work and I wanted to sit home and enjoy, you know, Andy Griffith's show, you know, or the Virginian. We were, I think, kind of more open to stranger stuff like that.
This isn't the Rifleman. What the hell's a phaser? What, Chuck Connors shooting people? Come on. Oh, man. So where are we? Are we on Friday?
Yeah, let's move on to Friday. Let's see, Wild Wild West, another great, and I would certainly consider it a genre show.
Right? Oh yeah, it's a sci-fi Western, show.
Yeah, it totally is. Yeah,
it's steampunk,
and just again the wildest kind of premise. I guess they had to fill a lot of hours of prime time. I guess so. I guess you could slip something like this through, you know, where you go, it's a Western, but it's also this other thing, and then, you know, when you're making it, you actually make, you know, you can actually go even farther afield.
It's a Trojan horse show. But there's a few great examples of like Trojan horse shows where you're like, what can I sell them so that I can make the show I want to make?
I think that's exactly what happened here, right? Because I don't think you go in and pitch Wild Wild West in all the accoutrement that we loved, you know, the things that made it like super special, all the steampunk stuff, as you say. You sell it as, it's a, you know, he's an agent for the government, and he works for, you know, Ulysses S. Grant, but he has his own train that he goes
James
places.
James Bond, Wild West. Kind of,
yeah, Have Gun Will Travel. He travels around and rights wrongs, and then, you know, he'll wear tight pants, you know.
That's key. Yeah,
and if we're lucky, we can get Bob Conrad, and then you totally make it into the awesome show that it was. Here's Green Hornet again is on this night. Again, didn't quite carry the Batman flag to the degree that I think they were hoping or expecting.
It looked cool. The car was awesome. And like the gun was cool. Yes. But yeah, it just didn't.
Yeah.
It was so superficial. Like, which sounds silly when we're comparing it to the Batman 66 show. Mm-hmm. But there was nothing else there.
Yeah. No, they did. They did the same kind of like not particularly strong premise stories, right? But like Batman did essentially. But Batman was popular and successful and entertaining because it was not about the stories, right? This one was kind of like about the stories and not, you know.
And had no villains. Yeah. Like, you know, they don't have Egghead Vincent Price, you know. Like, I can't think of a single villain from the Green Hornet show. Like, not even one.
I guess at the heart of the Green Hornet is the idea that the police essentially think he's a criminal.
Yeah. Right?
So it's kind of very Batman-like. You know, it's Batman-like. It's Batman-like in the more recent incarnations of Batman, or the darker side of Batman, right? But they never really kind of played that up at all, you know, to any degree.
And I think they
pitched it. I think it would be too edgy.
They pitched it also more like with the Lone Ranger connection that's there too, because I think he's supposed to be like the Lone Ranger's great grandson or something.
Yeah.
Which was probably like from the network's perspective, we're like, Lone Ranger sold, you know? Then, you know, that sort of idea of almost like being in the family business of vigilanteism, or like, is an interesting thing that like they touch on a little bit. And it wasn't a serious show, but like, that's an interesting idea to me that they completely just abandoned. Yeah. And it could have been better. And again, another show I'm surprised never got a reboot.
No, you're right. But maybe for all the reasons that you're saying. Yeah. You actually, I think, hit a large nail on the head, which is it didn't have the kind of the villains, the regular villains, which is important, I think, to these, you know, shows like this. Certainly was to Batman. Then we've got Hogan's Heroes, which is an entertaining show, but it was one of the odder premises to ever get on the air. And then obviously what we know about Bob Crane now
makes it
kind of additionally watchable.
It's also crazy to me. He's just perving and making weird sex.
Yeah, loops. No. Oh, you can make your own in your own head. You can make it a whole other show watching Bob talking to pretty much everybody, you know.
But like the thing about Hogan's Heroes that's crazy to me is that it was like 20 years from the events of World War II to making a silly sitcom about it. That's not that long.
No, it's we're essentially the same time as from 9/11 till now.
Right.
So let's
make a funny first responder show.
9/11. Yeah.
You and I'll
go out and pitch the 9/11.
The fire station that's digging through the rubble. You know, these guys are wacky. Yes,
exactly. I think that's we were more forgiving, I guess, back then than we are now. We have longer memories.
Maybe to a fault.
And then exactly. And then 9 o'clock has one of the many attempts by Tim Conway to succeed in a sitcom. You know Tim Conway's personalized license plate back in the day?
No.
13 weeks. 13 weeks was his personalized license plate. And Rango is a good example of why that was made sense.
He's a Boston guy, I believe. He was had a radio comedy show with Ernie Anderson, Paul Thomas Anderson's father, who was the voice of ABC. They were both on a radio station here in Lynn. And I believe it was the same radio station that Bob and Ray started on.
That's interesting. My sister worked for him for a while, a few years ago, so long after retirement. And he would always say, when people would recognize him, come up to him, before they would say anything, he goes, You're so pleased to meet me. And it wasn't an ego thing. It was just, that's exactly what everybody would say to him.
Yeah.
I'm so pleased to meet you, you know? So he just like beat them to it, you know, sounds very, very,
I did the HBO Aspen Comedy Festival in 2006 and Norman Lear was there. And I never bother anyone. Like, I'm horrifically embarrassed to bother people. I never ask for a photo or anything. But I was like, it was Norman Lear. And I was like, I said, you know, excuse me, Mr. Lear, I'm sorry to bother you. And he goes, "You already have," which was funny, but also I'm like, yeah.
was he being funny or was he?
I think he was making a joke, like, because then he was nice and he talked to me and took a photo and everything.
But okay, he was being nice. Okay.
Yeah, but it was such like a it was that kind of thing. I was like, oh,
too late. And then wrapping up the night, THE Cat, which I did like, I enjoyed that too. Robert Loggia.
Yeah.
Nothing special about it, but fabulous, title sequence. Also in music for that.
Plus Robert Loggia is like infinitely watchable, and Ted Knight is the villain in this episode.
Yes, I know. Yeah. Ted Knight's another one who's at the end of Psycho, the movie Psycho. He's one of the guards that puts him in the cell. So I gotta redo my list of people that I'm gonna, you know, dive bomb with. You were great in Psycho because they all seem to have all passed away. So I need to update my list.
My Ted Knight thing I would say to him is, I loved your narration on the Super Friends. He was the guy that went and justice matter. That's Ted Knight.
Yeah. No. That's great. And he was for the Mary Tyler Moore show, he was quite the find. In the same way that with Mary Tyler Moore on the Dick Van Dyke show, the original Dick Van Dyke show, they didn't know what they had. They just cast her as the wife, thinking she'd be a little more straightforward. And she was just obviously incredible, had these incredible comedy chops. And the same with Ted Knight. If you watch the first few episodes of the Mary Tyler Moore show, he's much more straightforward, kind of doing George Putnam, who was a conservative newscaster here in L.A. And he's basically doing him. And then obviously, you know, they discovered that he could actually be incredibly funny.
Oh, yeah. So, anyway, let him loose. It's great.
So so it's now Friday and I completely I failed to do any homework all week long. So I need to catch up over the weekend. But that started Saturday morning again with cartoons. So that's why
it served you well, though.
Didn't go to college. It did serve me well. Yes. I just noticed that the Avengers is on, too. So maybe this is the live one. Yeah. I mean, when it's airing fresh.
Melanie Chardoff told me my favorite thing I ever heard about Patrick McNee, because she had befriended him later in life. And I guess he used to just travel the world and stay in these like mansions, but he never had any money. And she was like, "How do you do this?" And he goes, "Have two good stories and don't stay more than 3 days."
Okay, that's ingenious. That's absolutely like, ingenious.
That makes sense.
That totally works. I thought you were going to mention he was a nudist, apparently. So,
I believe that too. That would be why you wouldn't stay more than 3 days, but you'd probably get some good stories.
Because you gotta be clothed. Yes. Yeah, by the fourth day, you're just ready to drop trow.
I can't deal with it anymore. But you mentioned there was a thing at the back end of the magazine that you.
Let me find that. Okay, for anyone that wants essentially a novella about Lawrence Welk.
Yes.
Okay. That tells absolutely everything there is to know about him. You definitely need to get this episode, this issue.
With some wonderful photos. Some
cheesecake photos of Barbara Bain in what is a full length sleeve, very baggy kind of schmock. It's schmock. I guess it's a loose fitting batik dress.
Yes.
Who knows such
the things. Word is batik.
Yes. And it's very sexy because it comes to just slightly above her knee.
Ooh, it's so controversial.
Yes, exactly. So that's for those who can dare to see it. That is their swimsuit issue contribution. And then there's Cleveland Amory, the reviewer, reviews the Avengers
with a great Al Hirschfeld drawing.
That is a great drawing. And then he kind of it's not unlike the Asimov thing. It's a little bit stream of consciousness. Because I don't think Cleveland Amory, again, was like, whatever, I'll just write something, you know.
Right. Kids show.
I don't feel he had a point of view. And yeah, I don't feel he had a point of view necessarily going into it, or maybe had a vague one and then just decided that he needed to write 1,000 words. So he just kind of let it go. So he starts out liking it, but liked it better last season. And then he kind of talks about how it's gone off the rails, and then just kind of it just kind of ends it. So it's just it's an interesting review in that he's not really trying.
He talks himself out of liking it by the end of the review. It's like a weird inner monologue this guy's having.
Yeah, you're right. It's the sort of thing that you would go back and now you're going to do another draft, you know, and then you go, okay, I'm going to.
Wait, did I like it?
Okay. And I hit word 1,000. I can now send it in and go to the pub. And then there is a tampon ad. In the back here, which is very discreet, but isn't as discreet as I would have expected it to be. It's just a cute young girl kind of smiling at the camera, sitting behind the wheel of a convertible car. Thought it was interesting.
It has a photo of a fully extended tampon. That's kind of shocking because I feel like they don't even show that in print ads now.
And, is that what that is? I didn't know that's what it was. No,
yeah, is that a mouse? It's a little telescope. Yeah. But the thing's called Meds, and it this is where we start getting that swinging hip youth culture thing, because it says Meds, the modest tampon. So it's mm-hmm. it's mod. You know what I mean? This is a fashionable one.
The mind reels at things I could say, but I'm not going to.
Yes, fair enough.
Yeah, exactly. And then there's one last the thing. There's a TV teletype, which also talks about kind of things that are upcoming. And so, again, among my favorite parts of the magazine, it's telling me about shows and pilots and things that are coming soon.
Including The Saint, which hadn't started yet. So we're getting Roger Moore, The Saint. Mm-hmm. And then there's a show that, speaking of Chuck Connors, this implies that this already aired a season. No, it doesn't. Cause I would have heard of this. It says ABC's Cowboy in Africa starring Chuck Connors. That sounds like a National Lampoon. How is that a thing?
Well, he's already got his gun, so right?
Cowboy in Africa.
I know.
Oh, Chuck Connors. He's another guy that fascinates me. What a weird career.
And, the question becomes, they shoot that on a back lot somewhere?
I imagine.
There were shows that did go internationally. And Ivan Tors was not kind of your usual straightforward Quinn Martin kind of producer. So, he's the sort that might have actually sold it as, no, we're going to actually shoot this in
that makes sense. Continent. Yeah, Flipper was shooting in Florida, which was really unusual. So you might be right.
Exactly.
But yeah, that did not go. Cowboy in Africa starring Chuck Connors.
Yeah, it's not one, unlike Man from U.N.C.L.E. and Mission Impossible, which got remade as movies. I don't remember a movie Cowboy in Africa.
Is there, to wrap up, is there a TV show from this era that didn't get remade as a movie that you would to see, or that you feel like is untapped?
That's a really good, I'm going to scroll through real quick and kind of see.
Sure.
I think the Crucible with George C. Scott.
The making of Under the Rainbow, but for that production of The Crucible with George C. Scott.
Yeah, really. What's bizarre is, as I leaf through it, or scroll through it, everything's been remade. Everything of any, The Fugitive.
Yeah.
Batman, obviously, in various incarnations. Lost in Space has been done. Beverly Hillbillies is a movie of that.
Yeah.
I don't know that they've done Green Acres, but I don't know that it necessarily needs to be titled Green Acres, right?
Invaders hasn't, but is that like irrelevant now?
Yeah, it is. I mean, yes, that's, there's so many, there's been so many things like that, right? And the title isn't sexy, you know what I mean? So I'm sure there are Invaders things have been on right now. So yeah, I'm just looking to see if there's...
Honey West is the only thing I can think of in there.
Yeah, I was thinking about that when you, because you'd mentioned it before. I don't know, it'd be a challenge, but to try to bring back the Ed Sullivan Show might be interesting.
That would be great. Well, with deepfakes, we could do it.
Yeah, that's actually, it's true. Okay. I don't know how huge an audience there'd be for, a not quite photo real Ed Sullivan, but
human variety show.
We could take a shot.
It could be, all right, here's the pitch. It's Ed Sullivan CG, like a Max Headroom, and he's hosting YouTube clips. It's going to be huge. It's the future.
And then the 23-year-old executive is going, Ed, who, what?
Is he? How much is he? He's big with the kids? Huge on TikTok, Ed Sullivan. Oh, man. Well, this has been great. I cannot thank you enough for doing this. Like, as I said, I've wanted to talk to you for a long time, and this was so much fun.
My pleasure. It's been a kick. I mean, look, obviously, talking about television is something is near and dear to me. So it's been a kick.
How great was he? I mean, he's worked on something you've loved, I assure you. Super nice guy, very smart, and just an amazing talent. That was such a fun conversation, and I'm sure you enjoyed it. If there are other people you'd like me to try to get on the show, you can email me at ken@icanread.com or tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. Also on some social media, depending on how evil the owner is at the present time, but I am at Kenneth W. Reed on most things, or at TV Guidance, or you can join our Patreon, patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. You give $1 a month, $2 a month. It is a massive help to doing the show. It costs me about $100-ish a month to make the show, and that doesn't count the time I put in, but you know, hey, it's free, and I didn't ask for this. I didn't ask you to listen. I kind of did, but if you have the means and you can spare a couple bucks, that is a huge help to getting the show done, and I appreciate it. Also doing more video content over on YouTube, so there is that as well. Anyway, I'll be here next week, and I hope you will too, for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
There's no Boston on Vulcan, my friend.